Another beautiful day, huh? What shall I do first? Ah, I know.
Hello there, and you've joined us on this...
In 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Well, well, here we are.
What can I say? I'm thrilled.
I want to congratulate you for being on time.
Ours is a brand new world of all-at-once. As the new electric technologies come into play, people are less and less convinced of the importance of self-expression. Teamwork exceeds private effort.
This is the Lazlow Show. Starring Big Wayne.
You banged a homeless girl, Wayne?
Yeah, she lived in a car. She wasn't homeless.
Well, you were on crack. You didn't know.
No, that was the girl who left me that I turned to the crack.
The girl who was living in a car. She broke your heart.
Yes.
Why? Was she pulled away?
And Pete, who wears a dress and rides a scooter.
I prefer to stay shrouded in mystery.
Dude, he's such a wuss.
One show, fighting to show him we're no dogs but men. Men who remember freedom, where 16-year-olds can drink and listen to metal music and smoke at bars and get into high-speed accidents. Men who have punch cards at Planned Parenthood. This is the Lazlow Show.
Lazlow Show. Some call it episode 24, some call it the super bonus episode. Tonight on the show, Big Wayne in Jamaica, how our show destroyed a relationship, gay cruise audio, Nazi hip-hop, drunk driving PSAs that make you want to drink. Also tonight, a brand new episode of Jaguar Skills, some puberty propaganda videos for Wayne to watch, comedian Rob Paravonian coming in, Jim Florentine calling in, but... since we always used to kick off the old show with a mashup, and this show could be a three-hour-long car crash, the king of car crashes hooks up with Jay-Z for Big Shot Pimpin.
It's Big Pimpin, baby.
Oh, Lazlow Show. Pretty good idea to buy a case of beer for the crew here, because they can't even figure out if we're actually on the air.
Except now Wayne has drank it all, basically. It looks like a convenient food mart in here with all his cans.
Yeah.
I've tapped into him.
Mm-hmm. How many beers have you had so far?
I'm on my second one.
Oh, I see. Mm-hmm. Danny's in there drinking. So this is the Lazlow Show. We should explain to the people who sort of aren't in the New York area or weren't fans of the old one. We have Big Wayne, who's a carpenter from Queens, who works on Long Island. He's sort of the sidekick kind of guy. And then we have Reed Tucker, who's been unemployed for...
Yeah, like going on 2 years now.
2 years, mm-hmm. Who was the no-good producer on the K-Rock show. And... first off, I got to thank ONA for letting us come in here.
Without a doubt.
I got to talk to Opie, and Wayne's already been blowing ass in Jim's chair.
Only in the chair, Jim. Not the microphone yet.
We have to burn the studio down when we leave.
So, like we said on the website, our show, like a lot of the email we've been getting, people are like, what happened to you guys since, you know, you sort of fell off the face of the earth? And we left K-Rock because we saw the iceberg coming. Which his name is David Lee Roth.
Right. That sucks.
Well, because we were on for, what, like 6 or 7 months on K-Rock.
Right.
And they all the way into the winter. And then, what, do we ask for $20 each? And they told us to go F ourselves?
Too busy giving $7 million to...
Is that what that clown got?
Something like that.
$7 million.
Correct. But...
So 3 months worth of work, because he's done.
On the last show, we brought up a little topic that got Reed in a little trouble.
Oh, I remember that. Fools just have to keep prying and have to keep prying.
It wasn't Reed. You should have... Come on. Do you want to fill out the listeners as to where we're at with this conversation?
We sort of started naming how many people we'd slept with.
Right.
And
a real man would tell the number.
What do you mean a real man would tell the number?
You should have made one up.
No, but there's no... That was my whole point back then, 4 months ago, when this wasn't even relevant then, but we're still talking about it. There's no... What's the right number? There's no right number that you can give anyone.
So
it's the honest number. If it was one, it's one. If it was 10, it's 10.
Okay, so what? You make up a number?
No, I didn't have to make up a number. I was honest.
Right. Okay.
Some of them I forgot, actually.
Wayne discounts how many HIV test receipts he's got pinned to the wall.
Do you break them into two categories, the homeless and then the legless?
No. This is whoever you had sex with, it counts.
All right.
You know? But, I mean, you blew a whole relationship. You had some time vested with
us what happened, because on the last show, we were pushing Reed to bring up how many chicks he slept with, and his girlfriend, who we nicknamed Yoko Ono, because she kept wanting to fucking break up the show, and obviously her issue wasn't just with us. After the show, Reed went home, and what happened?
Right, I got what they call in relationships the business, you know. So, you know, I wouldn't tell you guys, because like I said, there's no point in revealing that information, because you know how it is, Lazlow. There's no right number, and especially for your girlfriend. Either it's too high and you're a whore, or it's too low and you don't know what you're doing, or you're like innocent.
Not if you're basing your relationship on some type of trust and honesty.
No, I know. Well, see, okay, so now you're getting to it. That was exactly her point, was she asked me, you know, we've been going out for 2 years, and I never told her, because I don't want to know
Fucking years.
2 years.
And she did not know how many women you've slept with.
No, I've always...
They can usually tell by your experience, you know, like, when you're down there, if you're not, like, aiming for the right hole,
What do you mean you're not aiming for the right hole?
He's on a belly button or something, you know?
There's no wrong hole, Wayne.
Oh, yes, there is.
I think that's the first lesson I learned.
Yeah, there's a wrong hole. Don't you worry about it.
Why, have you hit it?
No, but when you do, you're sleeping on the couch. Not even by accident do you hit that.
So I'm taking relationship advice from this guy.
So she, and this ended up, like, quite an issue.
So this started the big snowball of trust, you know, because I didn't want to tell her, because I didn't want to know how many she had done, because, you know, that shit just eats away at you.
Does it?
Don't you think?
No.
Really?
No, I'd want to know.
Here's how it goes in this conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And I sort of understand where Reed's coming from. The first tier is how many chicks have you slept with? The next, and it never stops there, right? When you say, how many chicks have you slept with? How many guys have you slept with? Then it goes to... Reed has got to ask her, have you ever slept with a black guy? And then the next tier after that is, have you ever been rotisseried at a, you know, like a big party when you were, and then you woke up and you were pregnant?
All that happens. But, you know, the thing is that if she's going to tell me a number, if I'm going to tell her a number.
Did she give you a number?
Well, she did. She what was her number?
She said 12.
12? Wow.
But I don't know if that was true or not.
How old is she?
Yeah.
27, 28. No, but
Were you 12 or were you 13?
I don't know. Good question.
Yeah. I'm a homosexual. I like men.
That's the first thing you should have been finding out.
Thank you, boy George. But I'm saying, you know, when anyone tells you that, you do that math in your head where you take the number of people that they've slept with minus the number of serious relationships that you know they've had.
Right.
And it's not that many. And so that leaves like a lot of just like, you know, random encounters in a back alley of a bar where you're getting banged or something.
So, and it ended up...
Termination.
Termination. Sinking the relationship.
Are you even friends?
Oh, we're friends, yeah.
Does she listen to the show tonight?
No.
Okay, just...
No, here's what happened.
Hold on.
Reed called me, and he goes, yeah, me and Yoko, we're kind of taking a break. You know,
it's not you, it's me.
We've been talking for a while, and we're going to, you know, just take a break. And I said, Reed, you know, it works really well. And he goes, really? Does it help, Lazlo? And I said, yes, Reed, I've been taking a break. Me and this chick have been taking a break for about 13 fucking years. That means you fucking broke up, dude. It's over. And you still had this shred of hope that you were going to get back together with her.
It could happen.
See?
Between me and you, you can do better.
Oh, man.
That's why I had to ask if she was listening. She's going to hate me anyway. But
now it all comes out. Now all the truth comes out.
Yeah. You're the only single guy on the show. Someone's got to be available. Mm-hmm. I know you can do better.
I appreciate it. But unfortunately, our fan base, I think, is 14-year-old dudes who play video games. So if I want to bang one of them...
Like I said, you can do better.
No, our fan base, since Wayne's a carpenter on Long Island, a few of the carpenters he worked with actually bought XM radios.
Yep.
And what are they doing right now?
Well, those are actually some electricians, but they were talking about getting a couple 8-balls to listen to this show, and I don't see how that works, but if these guys are partying up...
Why is everyone who listens to our show either drunk or stoned or doing an 8-ball?
It's probably the only way to enjoy it.
Yeah, exactly.
But, I've done blow, and never did I say, you know what, it's time to listen to the radio.
No, yeah, you want to like drive to Kentucky or something when you do that, or I hear people like clean their house.
I just think you want to call the dealer back and tell them you need another 8-ball.
So what did you do, Lazlow, after you did blow? Like, what were you?
I actually played Sega Golf for about 3-4 hours.
Oh, you did what?
I played Sega Golf.
I would never even have the concentration to do that.
Really?
Trust me, you have the concentration when you're whacked on blow.
And how was your sexual function during that time?
Huh?
How was your sexual
function? Dude, you're just sitting around with a bunch of friends.
You ever get coke cock? You're familiar with that?
I think I have had coke.
How about you, Reed?
No, I've never done coke before.
Well, there's this little amazing feature that happens to it. It makes your penis shrivel.
I don't know if I'd call that amazing.
Oh, it's amazing.
That's why you put the coke on your cock, dude.
I never went that far. That's crazy.
So what, you can't get hard at all?
I think in the beginning, if you were very, you know, functioning and then you started using, you might be able to still function. But in the middle of a good binge, I don't think you're even thinking about it. Like I said, you're thinking about the next line.
Wow.
So, I called Reed last night. I was watching the worst documentary ever. Rosie O'Donnell. Did you hear about this with the cruise?
Yeah.
Dude, it was like the movie Titanic, except gay.
Mm-hmm.
It was brutal. Now, if you were doing a documentary about an entire cruise ship that is exclusively gay... What do you think he would start it off with? What would all the gay people get on the boat? What would they do?
Naked?
No.
Women or men?
No. Men and women.
Well, women would play softball and.
Nope.
Okay.
Musical. Musicals every night.
Thanks for breaking down the stereotypes.
Yeah. Musicals. Let's check this out. Rosie actually sings on this documentary. This is not Rosie.
Changed. Every cruise that was ranked first rate, even though they were really great, had a clientele only straight. But today, you can camp it up, don't be shy.
See, this is what's exciting, because normally when you're on a cruise ship, you can't be really flaming. You just have to suck it in, so to say. And then Rosie comes out with her big beach ball fucking head, right? And starts
this whole documentary was Flame Fest 2006. It's on HBO. I'm sure it's going to repeat. Each gal and I.
Whether gay, straight, trans, or bi. Float around, what a ship.
Can you imagine the hell of being on this fucking boat, dude?
No.
As a straight, like, employee? Because you know there were people on the boat that had to work that shift, and they're like, dude, you've got the fucking gay shift. You're going to come back with the...
I'm sure.
You're going to come back with the HIV, fool.
It might have been some good comedy, though.
Maybe.
So, and a lot of these people on the boat actually had children, and they were complaining about discrimination.
It was Labor Day weekend, just outside of Richmond, and I think Hope was about 4 or 5 years old. Sal and I were stopped by the state police on suspicion of kidnapping.
I asked the officer, well, so why are we suspected? Well, because you're two men traveling with a child, and you were in the back seat, like, trying to keep the kid quiet. Yeah, that...
With my cock. So there's like they're upset because this cop pulled him over. There's a flaming guy rolling around in the back seat with a struggling child, while another flaming guy is in the front seat, probably, you know, leaning back, screaming his head off. And the cop just drives up and hears that shrill sissy voice. Are they shocked that they got pulled over?
And it is in Richmond, so, you know, that's where I'm from, and they don't tolerate much down there.
Right, exactly.
No.
The officer, well, so why are we suspected? Well, because you're two men traveling with a child, and you were in the back seat, like, trying to keep the kid quiet. Yeah, that's exactly the point. I'm the parent. I'm trying to keep the child entertained. If we were two women, that wouldn't have happened.
Correct.
But can you remember the days, like, even maybe 2 or 3
when you
years?
Can beat a faggot?
No. What? They're still here those days. No. This, right. Like 2 years ago, remember when it was sort of a mystery whether Rosie O'Donnell was gay or not? You know, some people
what
would
kind
say,
of mystery? What was a mystery to you, dude?
No,
you're...
that was a mystery. Before she came out, you know, people were like, there were all these questions about it. And now it's just like, how could anyone have been so stupid? She looks like Wayne.
I don't think it was that hot. No, she don't look like Wayne.
Wayne's got a dreadlock beard down to his waist.
That's my point.
She does it.
If a vag looks like my face, stay away from it.
I don't even know what that meant.
And so another great part of this was, I guess there's this famous NFL player, Asera Tualo. He's played on like a bunch of different teams. Mm-hmm. But I guess... he sort of came out in this documentary, and he had a football camp for all the boys.
This is when I weighed about 340 pounds.
He's evidently lost a little weight due to some disease that he's got.
40 pounds playing for the Green Bay Packers. I played for a couple teams. I played for Green Bay, and then I went to the Minnesota Vikings. Ready, set, go! Well, nice throw, nice throw. Now, you got to remember now.
Can you imagine learning football? Because the kids aren't gay, you know. They're like, oh, they're all adopted.
Not yet, they're not.
The gay agenda.
Yeah, exactly.
I love that. Oh, it's always the homosexual agenda. Let me tell you what the homosexual agenda is. Right. Going to musicals, dressing nicely, and getting banged in the ass.
And spending a lot on furniture.
Right. They don't want to recruit your ass in anything.
No.
Well, nice throw. Nice throw. Now, you got to remember now. I played on defense.
He wasn't very good.
No. Does he throw like a girl?
No, he's
the
more
point
into
there?
Catching than he is pitching.
Remember now, I played on defense. I was not an offensive player. So throwing the ball is not my forte, but tackling somebody is my forte.
Come on, just listen to the guy's speech.
Whoa,
you
now.
Know he's flaming.
Evidently, some people in these claiming people in the NFL didn't.
But tackling somebody is my forte. See, like this. many times before I was in the closet doing football camps like this, having to be somebody that I wasn't. But this is incredible that these kids know who I am, and I'm still a role model for them.
Give me five.
Ow!
This kid, he must be in like the late stages because this kid gave him like a high five and
I
broke
his
wrist.
His ass. Get along.
Let's hit the showers.
Do you know anything else about him, Laz?
What?
You know, no. In the book that he came out with, he actually announced that one of his teammates, didn't give out a name, is also gay and he had an affair with him.
That's great.
Yeah. What team did he play for?
Green Bay.
Oh.
That's only a matter of elimination.
Well, what are there, 80 guys on a football team? What are you saying?
You can figure out who his partner was.
Jason in Queens wants to know if you had any other erectile dysfunction. Jason.
Yeah.
You, go. All right. First call of the show.
There goes my erectile dysfunction right there.
And it says here on the thing, can't get hard on crack. What do you, Jason?
Yo, Lazo, what's up, man?
Hello?
Can you hear me?
And he's gone.
Oh, see why you got to do that?
Because it says it can't get hard on crack. You can't talk on crack either. Fucking retard.
Yeah, stay away from those calls from Queens.
So now I want to know, what was Stan doing? He just came and sat down for a little bit, and he sort of surfed the internet, and then now he's changing places with E-Rock.
Tag team.
By the way, E-Rock, nobody has brought this up on O&A, but you on the our last K-Rock show was on the 18th. It was the weekend after Howard's last show. Mm-hmm. And you and Wayne,
I was involved a little bit, but you looted that place like New Orleans,
like downtown Baghdad. You got some toner and
dude, he had fucking toner cartridges.
Nah,
you were like Schwoogie level 5, dude. You Heineken's. Have you talked about this at all in public?
Heineken's.
There was no beer there. We would have drank that.
That was a New Orleans reference.
Yeah.
Oh, people fucking surf the internet or look at wag bag.
Right, yeah. I thought they just stole jeans.
What did... Now, see, Reed can't be completely blameless either, because a couple of days later...
Oh, no.
Yeah, I heard you made some money. You didn't exactly split it.
Well, you want your cut? What are you... Yeah. I got to give you a tribute?
There were a few eBay auctions of Howard Stern merchandise.
A few. There isn't one... No, there was that whole box of trash that they were throwing away.
Right.
Trash to who?
Trash to the street.
E-Rock said that he was going to come hang out on the show, and in the first hour, you were gone, making trips to the fucking car. Come on, dude.
Back that thing up.
I know not what you speak.
All right. I'm done with you.
Yeah.
Rosie O'Donnell, this is the best part. They pull into the Bahamas. Like, you know, they stopped in a lot of friendly places, but I guess the Bahamas got wind of the gay boat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, several thousand gay people coming. You know, which you can tell as soon as they're getting off because they're all wearing Birkenstocks.
By the way, what do you wear?
I don't wear fucking Birkenstocks.
Come on, those
dude.
Shoes you were wearing the other day.
Those are Vans.
Yeah, well, are they?
Yes.
They say fag.
So they pull into the Bahamas, and there's like this enormous protest.
There are children coming off of our ship, and it's like, I don't want them to have to see this.
And the Bible says that the sin of homosexuality is an abomination of God.
Christianity gets a really bad name.
So these, so some of the cruise ship members, to be politically correct, go start a little argument with. What's weird is all the people in this protest seem to be of African American descent.
Christianity gets a really bad name from the hate mongers, because it looks to gay people like Christianity equals hate.
This is something that has been advertised.
So this is one of the protesters that's bum-rushing one of the gay families. When I say gay families, I mean two dudes.
This is something that has been advertised, that we go into the Bahamas.
Sure. We're very happy to come here.
As though the Bahamas is a playground for this kind of thing.
No, the whole world is a playground for gay people. We live...
You know what? Maybe not the whole world. Parts of Kentucky.
Alabama, maybe.
Probably don't want you.
No.
There's a good area below the Manson-Nixon line. Just not interested in dealing with your whole... The whole world is a playground for gay people, right?
I'm canceling my tickets to the Bahamas.
Yeah.
Why? You don't want to go to a place that's got oppression?
Yeah, without a doubt.
It's a playground for gay people. We live everywhere.
The Bahamas is not...
We live everywhere.
The Bahamas is not
gay
a playground.
Gay people live here, you know.
Yes, but what we don't want is you parading in our streets flirting.
Flirting.
That's the thing with
that
me.
That word flirting, though, is kind of tricky.
So... This is the best part of the entire documentary, is they start making out, and all of these religious people, like, they're sort of like chasing the religious people making out in front of them, just to sort of see how they would how they would react. This one woman starts screaming Jesus babble.
Flirting.
That's the thing.
That word flirting, though, is kind of tricky.
No.
In the name of Jesus.
See, there you go.
We put on every spirit.
In the name of Jesus.
That you bring on our show.
You're hateful in the name of Jesus. Learn what
Jesus
was and what he taught. Learn what Jesus taught. Learn what Jesus taught.
You are a nasty sissy.
A nasty sissy.
She sounds Jamaican.
Yes.
It's crazy. And it can they really be afford to be turning people away from the Bahamas?
Seriously.
Last time I checked, it was like one crab shack and a burnt out souvenir stand. So you know what? These people bring all these money in there, and these guys are lining up all self-righteous, turning people away.
Right.
Well, get out.
All those other boats, that's okay.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
And, you know, you figure, like, of disposable incomes, the fat guy and his fat, stinky wife and their two annoying children are going to get off the boat and sit there and haggle with you about your $3 for $10 crappy t-shirts. You got a boatload of sissies, disposable income.
That's mad money,
mad money, dude. Yeah. They might come buy your shit.
Yeah. It's also good to know that there's crazy right-wing Christians everywhere, and it's not just American.
Right. Mm-hmm. There's even ones in the Bahamas. So, the war on Christmas was celebrated by Big Wayne.
Yeah, man.
Remember we were talking, he was going to go to Jamaica
and
skip Christmas.
Because he no longer celebrates Christmas.
Yep.
Because you're done.
I'm done.
Wayne, around our friends and when we meet people are a little scared of him. Because he looks
intimidated,
like 240 pounds or some odd. You look kind of like a biker because you used to be.
Mm-hmm.
You got a dreadlock beard down to your waist. He went down to Jamaica, and it was like the motherland.
I got treated like royalty.
It was your boys down there.
I mean, people came out of their houses. I'd be walking down the street, and they'd come out of their houses, come walking over to me. Yeah, man, what's up? It's like after a while, you got to say, yeah, man, back, because that's all everyone ever says.
Even though you're a white dude?
Well, even though I was a white dude,
yeah.
And they started just giving me weed. I didn't have to buy weed. They gave it to me.
And not just like a joint.
No, a bag of weed.
Like the guy gave like two
pounds of weed for like $65. I got it stashed, so when I go back, I don't have to bother going anybody.
Would you bury it on the beach?
No,
you got a treasure map?
I rented a house, and I, you know, carpenter, I figured out how to hide it, that no one would find it.
What did you do, like take the floor apart?
Very similar, yes.
Nice.
Yeah, you know, when you travel, you want to hide your stuff, so when I got there, the vanity's kind of like built in the bathroom, because the house is like 100 years old. So you just pull out the drawer, and the cabinet all stays there, and I drew all my shit behind the drawer, and I put the drawer back in. And I guarantee you, no one will ever find it.
Nice. Some of those people from the gay cruise next summer are going
to
stumble on that.
Anybody ever wants to get away for Christmas, it's an excellent place to visit for Christmas, because first of all, they celebrate Kwanzaa. So, you know, you don't have to say any of that shit, Merry Christmas. Not one iota of Merry anything Christmas.
Did you have a Kwanzaa tree?
No Kwanzaa tree. Mm-hmm. But it's an amazing place. You ever get a chance to get away? I'm not going to tell you where I stay, and all you people should go stay at those resorts.
See, he went to the back country.
Yes.
I sent him, I was sort of his travel helper.
Yes.
I sent him to the back country, you know.
The woods.
Yeah.
I was in the woods.
Where it's like.
He never told me this. I figured I'd get off the plane, I'm there. I get off the plane, I'm in a car ride for 2.5 hours. There isn't a straight piece of road that goes 30 feet, and it's a sharp left, a sharp right. I'm in the car 30 minutes. I'm ready to vomit. It just flew for 3 hours. And I was like, this is amazing, you know? And so then when you get there, the whole thing in my mind is, it's a 3-hour ride back, you know? And it is amazing. These roads, just they go through mountains and nothing is straight. And there's crazy goats and jerk chicken stands and. Yeah.
Nice.
I said, any white guy, if you're intimidated by black people, don't go. But if you're not, you'll have a great time.
You know, I was talking to Cousin Ed the other day, and somehow I said, you know, we're doing the O&A, I'm going to be on their channel for a night, and we started talking about the last show, and I just found out recently what actually went down, because there's something about, since I've been on O&A a few times, and we've hung out at their Halloween party and stuff like that, and hanging out with the crew, it's like you somehow get blacklisted. In this end, like I was going to be on Sirius on this like Playboy channel, they were going to have me call in and do like a tech thing, and I got a call back and said, "Oh no, you're with O&A," and I was like, "You know what? Fuck you then. Stay, your fucking magazine stinks."
Right. It's like West Side Story up in this piece.
Seriously, then I did that. And I said, I'm out, nigga.
The Jets and the Sharks.
Right. Who won?
What? I don't know.
No one really won. Isn't that the moral of the story? No,
I don't know.
It's about love.
Dude, listen. If you fight or dance, okay?
Nice.
I'm glad that the African American people figured out to stop with the fucking windmills and the body popping and get to shooting. All right? That's all well and good with your electric boogaloo, but I want to see some gats pulled and some fucking drive-bys.
Nah, dude, we're going to have to take your wrist with somebody from Sirius and tie it together, and then you guys are going to have a knife fight.
But, so, E-Rock was with us on our last show.
At
K-Rock. And I guess somehow somebody said ONA, whatever. These union guys, and I didn't know this was going on out in the hall. There's this room where there's CD burners, where we burn copies of the show, and then we post the shows on the web, and then like people from Africa and God knows where download our show for whatever reason. And what are you doing over there?
Pint of Guinness.
All right.
There's new rules here. New fucking rules.
And so...
Rule doesn't come into effect.
Did you bring some?
Yeah, sure.
Five minutes before the show starts, the CD burners go dead. And I finally found out why everything was sabotaged. Because Wayne and Cousin Ed are off in the hall squaring off with these fucking pro-Howard Stern union guys that are tearing apart Howard's old studio. And they're, like, yanking wires on our studio trying to sabotage our show.
Well, they did, but... they're lucky.
What happened out in the hall, dude?
I asked one of these guys how much they were making. You know, I figured,
right, that's not
it's like a Sunday night. It's triple time. Just give me an idea what you make in an hour.
Yeah, but dude, I was sitting there. You didn't even ease into it. You were like, hey, you guys, how much they paying you?
Yeah.
And the guy got real mad real quick.
Well, he was
a
pussy.
He didn't look like a pussy, dude.
He was a pussy.
He's going to kill you.
Dude, he didn't get in my face. That's all I know.
What happened?
He turned around and walked away and got one of his other guys.
No, you guys...
I heard that you and Cousin Ed fucking started bumping chests
with
these guys.
You were screaming at each other.
Screaming,
over nothing.
Wow.
Over nothing. I was there.
Wow.
Yeah, well, you know, thanks a lot, because it, like, completely fucked up the vibe before the show.
Hey, listen, we were going out hostile anyway.
Wayne was all ready to throw down with Nick Carter.
Loser.
Nick, we're on the
you like that, huh?
It finally comes out. Hatred.
We're on the train in. He's like, I'm gonna start me a radio war. I'm like, dude, don't see, we're on for one night. You ain't starting no fucking radio war.
But the best is, you know, he thinks he's really good.
But you should explain who he is.
Right,
Nick Carter is like the...
Go ahead, explain it, but then...
Go ahead. Just so people know, Nick Carter's what, a DJ at...
Yeah, he was doing Saturdays and Sundays. It wasn't like a DJ. Saturdays and Sundays ain't a DJ. He's kind of just filling in dead time where people that listen every day aren't listening.
Right.
But anyway, the weird thing is for me, last week I'm going to work and it's like 4:45 in the morning and all of a sudden 6 o'clock comes in and he's doing a, hey fellas, come on in, get your jet ski going. And I'm like, change up the opening. It sucks. He's terrible.
Yeah. You nearly got in a fight with him, like, before our show a couple of times.
Yeah, he couldn't take the racial overtone. I actually didn't know he was black.
Evidently, there's a I don't know, I think he's a mulatto mongrel.
Yeah, he can be.
Race of DJ.
I'm sure this is all getting to him right now.
So is there anyone you don't want to fight?
There's...
No, I don't want to fight anybody.
Carpenters,
evidently,
DJs.
Jim says there's a gay day at Disney World.
Sure.
Jim?
Gosh, it's huge.
Yeah.
What kind of gay day do they have at Disney World?
I think they have it monthly, like the first... I'm not sure, but it's more than once a year.
First
and sometimes, well, anyway, I was not homophobic or anything like that before that day, but I am now. It was extremely upsetting, I guess, depressing. I was.
Somebody give you a reach around on Magic Mountain? Yeah. What happened?
No. Well, it's kind of like what y'all were talking about in that clip that y'all were playing. They're there solely to advance an agenda.
What agenda? They want to ride a stupid ride and buy some cotton candy.
No, it's... I mean, when you see... if it would have been a man and a woman making out like this, it would have been disturbing. I mean, I think they're there solely for shock value because Disney will let them in. But anyway, I like the show. Is this the first one?
Yeah.
Yeah, so far the last.
It's not a regularly scheduled thing. It's just a
no,
deal.
No, write your congressman and ELO. Thanks.
Okay,
was he listening to any of the promos?
Dude, half of these calls, people got questions about how to fix their fucking iPod.
Let's take one.
This ain't a tech show. Mike? Mike?
Yeah, what's up, man?
What's wrong with your iPod?
Nothing. I'm just trying to see if you know of any software out there where you can put videos on it, like Windows Media videos or whatever.
Nice. What are we, Radio Shack?
Yeah, hold on. We're
going
to get to that by the end of the program.
Nice. Well, you are the tech guy. See, that's you were pissed off.
Yeah, I'm the tech guy, and it took me like 10 seconds to figure out how to hang up on that fool.
Mm-hmm. But go ahead.
Has anybody heard of, like, the Geek Squad? Go to Best Buy.
Really? Actually, no. You know what's bad is that I just recently got a new computer.
Oh, back God.
I jumped into the 21st century.
Cannot believe that.
His girl's ready to leave him. Yeah. He doesn't even know how to make a folder on the desktop, dude.
Oh, man. What kind of computer did you get?
I got a Dell.
All right, so tell me this. When you hooked up to the internet, what was the first website that you visited?
I'd have to say, I think someone sent me a video of when I did the Rockstar bodyboard event this summer. That was the first one. Bodyboarding. That was it.
Porn.
No. Nope.
See, come on, dude. What happened with this old computer?
Porn was going to contaminate my computer, so I actually stayed away from it, but
You got to understand what happened to Wayne's previous computer. He bought it, and within about 3 months, it was so infested because he goes to these Prego sites.
Yes, I love the Pregos.
And
Prego?
Prego chick.
Not sauce.
Oh.
Pregnant women.
I love them. Pregnant and lactating.
Jesus.
So if there's any women out there right now in that position, please call in.
What gets you off about
that? I don't know what it quite is, but there's just something about it.
Mm-hmm.
I find the pregnant woman very attractive.
Mm-hmm.
And the lactating.
Doesn't it kind of come across as like a used car to you?
No.
You know what I mean? Dude, that wrecks a body.
Oh, yeah.
Some of them come back.
So there's a lot of pregnant porn out there.
Oh, my God. There's a ton of pregnant porn.
Wow. Aren't they denting in the baby's head?
Come on. What are you thinking? They're denting the baby's head?
Something bad happened?
No one's that huge. Denting the baby's head.
Greg up in Boston. Big fan of Nick Carter.
Uh-oh.
Hey, what's going on, Laz? I like your little drops in XM once in a while, too. They're pretty cool.
Thanks, dude.
I just got a question for you. Nick Carter still has a job because he sucked up hair.
See? Thank you very much.
No, it's just, like, he had a huge, like, he took over for Mark Pirano when Pirano left, and, like, all the papers made a big deal about him up here. Then O&A came in and kicked his ass. Then when O&A went over to BCN, they made nice. But I saw him all the time, like, when I lived up in Brighton. He had a big house and everything. He was just a prick.
Thank you.
A big, you know, he just plays it off, and you know how PC radio is nowadays.
Right.
He's like, oh, look at me. Oh, God, you know.
You know,
he had this moment in the early 90s, like when BCN was going through transition, but he couldn't hold it. He sucks. I can't believe he still has a job up there.
He doesn't.
Here's what annoys me about radio. I got out of radio in, like, I mean, I still did the Technophile, and I still do that, but I stopped working at a station in 99 and went to go work at an ad agency where I met my good friend Reed Tucker. And so...
I mean, you didn't meet him through the glory hole?
It was so, like, it's such a backstabbing piece of shit. And we started our show at K-Rock, and I had one of my friends I've known for, like, 11, 12 years calls me and says, dude, Nick Carter just called me and said and started talking trash about you and your buddies and what a shitty show you do. And he had no idea that you and I are best friends. It's just, like, the fucking trash talking, because it's like...
He was a little jealous.
It's the whole industry drives me nuts.
Right, because I had a friend of mine that interned, like she interned on his show, and he just said he just came in and he thought he was, you know, he thought he was it, and you know,
I think we gave enough time to Nick Carter.
Dude, there's like 18,000 people calling about Gay Day at Disney.
Maybe they know what day of the week it is.
So, Wayne, I have to have a little bit of an intervention because, like, I have my own chick. Who I, you know, like, trying to sort out my own relationship.
Right.
You got to step up and do something, because your girl asked you if you would take her car to go get washed, and you told her...
I'm a busy guy.
...to go to my house and use the hose.
I did ask her to go to last one, because you're all set up for it, dude. You pull up, there's the bucket, the sponge, the brush,
and
the vacuum.
Right. So she comes over, and there's all this stuff broke on her car that I fixed... I vacuumed it. Dude, listen, all I know is I had, like, sexy car wash action going on with your girl over at my, like, I, you know, accidentally, like, I was spraying the car down and I did that whoopsie across her boobs, you know?
Good for you.
Yeah. She's wearing high heels.
You gotta, right, exactly.
He's definitely fantasizing right now.
Listen, all I know is you need to step up, because if you don't, the swinging's gonna start.
You think so?
You got to, dude. If your girl asks you to do, you don't tell her to go to Lazlow's house.
Listen, my girl is very capable of fixing that herself. Okay, and she did give it two attempts.
But you ever think that's why she married a carpenter, dude? Right. So she doesn't have to sand shit around the house.
Have you ever heard the old expression? You know, the shoemaker's shoes. Did you ever see them on these kids?
Hold on a second.
Yeah.
Is this Little House on the Prairie?
Yeah,
I think Wayne just broke out some homespun wisdom from 1700.
Hey, listen, my parents are a lot older. When they were alive, they had these little expressions.
All right.
You know?
So you don't fix it. So you're saying you work all day, you fix things all day, and then when you come home, you don't want to fix
the
car.
I kind of should have did the right thing, but it was like always, it was like on Sundays, I was going to get to it. And not to say anything, but you know what? I'm a carpenter, and Lazlow knows, when I finish a project, it looks damn nice.
Mm-hmm.
What does this guy do? He takes a drywall screw and screws to the side of the glove compartment into the car. So now I look at it. Yeah, the glove box doesn't go open or close, and it's held together with a black drywall screw.
She goes, my glove compartment won't stay closed. I'm like, I'll fucking fix that. I get a drywall screw and a power drill.
Took care of it.
Yeah. Shit's taken care of, dude.
Mm-hmm. Hey, if she's not going to get it at home, she got to come somewhere else. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Correct.
I like that she goes to Lazlow to get it.
Yeah, Reed, but he's going to swoop in like a vulture.
Reed, we got some... A fan sent us a graphic novel.
No way.
I don't know, like, when this weird fad started, but this is like manga porn actually purchased in... I believe it was purchased in Tokyo. Uh-huh. This is the most disturbing shit I've ever seen. I don't know who is into this stuff, but like I was in Germany 3 weeks ago. There's 1-900 numbers for manga. Do you know what manga is?
No.
It's like the Japanese animation. Imagine like Speed Racer.
Yeah, it doesn't
like
do it for me.
Racer X, Bangin' Trixie. It's like they've all got enormous tits.
Right, and I don't understand why also rape is always a big fantasy in these things. Like, you know, when I was doing some research for the show, or so we'll say. You know,
when I was doing some research for the show, I was looking up some Asian chicks getting raped.
No, but you know, there's that whole genre of anime that is nothing but porn, and every single one of them, you can find them online, every single one of them deals with these, like, crazy schoolgirl rape fantasies. Where
all the chicks in that thing look like schoolgirls.
What is going on in Japan, dude? That's what I need to know.
They are fucked up.
They are messed up.
Dude, you were telling me about that video with the two chicks in the bathtub.
Oh, man. Yeah. I have one of my friends works as a vice cop in Queens, and so every once in a while he'll send me... I don't ever open any sort of files in his email anymore because it's always just the most disturbing, like, porn that he confiscates. And one time he had these...
His name Kenny?
No. Never mind. What the hell? No, but he sent me one time this video...
Keith?
No. Okay. What is it? Why are you guessing names?
Never mind.
No, he sent me this one video where it starts out innocent enough. It's like two hot Asian girls in the tub. It goes on for a little while. They're kissing, they're making out, they're fondling, and then all of a sudden one girl stands up, stands over the other girl, and just like vomits all over her. And the girl like claps her hands and she's like picking
pieces out
of the water.
There's no licking it or touch. Is there?
What do you mean?
Is there any, like, licking it or touching it after it?
Oh, yeah. She's picking pieces out of the water and eating them, and then the other girl vomits into the other girl's mouth.
Dude, O&A played this clip, this sound clip, and then I went and saw the video of that chick, like, the guy pooping in her mouth.
Yeah.
Now, that stuff disgusts me immensely, but I have to say, when we were introduced to a certain porn producer who came into our studio a few months ago to watch the tape of Wayne banging the homeless girl and critique his technique, we found out that this porn producer doesn't normally do the kind of porn that he took us to the set, which was just like two girls banging a guy. He does this other stuff and gave us these videos, and Wayne has been trying to get me, and my chick for that matter,
I'm addicted,
to come over and watch this stuff.
Yeah, it's called scatology. Okay? If any of you people don't know exactly what that is the...
We know.
...process of shitting and animals.
But Professor Wayne...
And if anybody's interested in getting one of these videos, you want to go to Black Mirror Productions.
Now, what's on them?
It's just every one of them ends with this
oh, I have a surprise for you. And they ripped to the side, and they got an enema bag. And
what's it full of? Paint?
Some of them been filled with yogurt, yes. And then,
no, not Billy. Do paint and yogurt are two different things?
No, I didn't say paint. I said some of them are filled with yogurt, and the girl chicks get a yogurt enema, and then they spew it all over the place.
Right. Is it granola or?
No. Actually, I think the one girl had 5 quarts up and couldn't get a drop back out.
I didn't see that one. Yeah. I did see one. He smoked.
And see, Reed has seen this. Reed, these videos too. I own them. I refuse because he gave them to us. I refuse to watch them.
But dude, you've got to at least check it out just to see what goes down in the world.
It's
you know
unbelievable,
what I'm saying, dude.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, he sells artwork.
Artwork, yeah. After the chicks do these enemas, they shoot them at canvases, and he's got them for sale on his website.
For like thousands of dollars,
and some,
right?
$3,000. It was amazing.
Right. It's crazy. But I then mean, there's...
But the one that really twisted my mind is there's this one chick that gets on a bed and pulls a sheet of plastic up over her, and she's underneath there with a little digital camera, okay? And another chick gets on top of her, in front of her, with her ass facing right at her, and just starts spewing the enema. And the chick's underneath the plastic, like, loving it, like, hey! Look at me.
wasn't there a birthday segment in this thing, too?
Oh, there was, yeah.
The birthday segment?
Yeah, remember, you know, it starts out, they always start out normal enough, and you're like, okay, yeah, maybe this won't be
right.
So bad.
But yes. then it's like a behind the music, and then things went terribly wrong.
And it all went down the drain. But this girl just basically takes a dump on a plate, and the dude sticks sparklers in it and lights it.
And he's like holding it underneath his nose and smelling the aroma. Right. And I was like, oh. Then he actually, hold on. Before you get to that scene, he had the chick pee in a garbage can.
That's right.
And he put that on the side, and then he brought the shit plate over with the sparkler on it.
And it had a shrine.
And had like an altar.
Yeah.
And it was like, we bow down and we pray and bless ourselves.
Are you serious?
And then he banged her in the ass.
And then he bangs her, then he bangs her in the ass.
Yeah.
Like, look at Reed's face right there.
I was disturbed. But this guy...
I'm addicted.
Clearly. But then there was the other one later in that same video where the guy smoked a bong out of the girl's ass. Did you see that?
Yes, that was incredible.
When does regular sex get so boring for you that you got to smoke a bong out of a girl's ass to get off anymore?
And, I mean, do you hear the water bubbling in her ass?
Oh, yeah, I know.
And then, hold on, then, you know, it ends, and she stands up, and this guy sticks his finger in her ass, and they run through, like, a whole long apartment to get to the bathroom, and she gets in the bathroom, and she says, oh, so proud to display it, like, on the walls of the shower.
But are you into that because you're actually
into this?
The
shock value. The shock value is
that's
incredible.
What we're saying, Lazlow. So why are you steering away, dude?
Wayne and I will be walking around, and he'll look at people, and he'll be like, I bet you that person's into enemas and shooting paint on the wall.
No one is into that except those three people in the video in the entire world.
I think there's a lot of people that are into that.
Paint enemas?
Everything.
What is it about that chair?
I gotta tell you, that fucking chair, Jim Norton's chair.
Well, maybe I need to turn Jim on to some scatology.
Oh, he knows about it, probably.
Trust me.
What do you think he's doing right now? It's Saturday night, dude.
Lady Trucker. Hello.
Hello.
So you slept with a Japanese man?
I lived in Japan for 6 months, and then I had to leave because...
They had a lot of rape fantasies?
You what?
Well, the reason why Japanese have fantasize about schoolgirl sex is because they have small penises.
Oh, really?
Uh-huh. And did you experience this firsthand?
Yes, sir.
No, okay, and you were a truck driver in Japan?
No, I was a military wife in Japan.
And
I'm a truck driver now in the States.
Oh, so you had to get a divorce?
No.
Okay. So are you still a military wife?
Well, he's retired now.
How many Japanese men did you sleep with? That's kind of you're making a sweeping generalization.
Well, yeah, it was four.
Was he 4 inches or was there 4 guys? Which is there?
4 guys.
Are they into crazy?
4 inches.
A total of 4 inches.
They love the, I hear that, like, I knew this chick that went over there. They evidently just are completely gaga over American women.
Yes, they go completely, absolutely. I mean, I'm a Buffalo Betty myself. And
Buffalo Betty.
Yeah.
Oh, and
they know what that is.
Yeah.
But they go nuts over the big tits and blonde hair and blue eyes.
So you could basically have any Japanese gentleman you like?
Yes.
Well, good for you. And where are you driving to tonight?
I'm in Arizona on my way to Arkansas.
All right. Have a good night, Lady Trucker.
I don't think you're going to run into any Japs over there.
The best, though, is these... I wanted to call one of these 1-900 manga porn
hotlines. Mm-hmm. I mean, because I sort of understand the graphic novels and stuff that have pictures of the, you know, Japanese schoolgirls. But right. all that, like, manga and anime is, like, some kind of weird futuristic thing, you know, where there's, like, robots that are killing people. And, I mean, what does the 1-900, like, number sound like?
I don't know. We should have called it.
You know, is it like,
if you want to fuck me after you keep the robots from destroying mankind, dial 1.
No, my favorite part when I was in Germany was watching South Park in German, just to hear Carmen go, Wagensdiefreund! That was the fucking best, dude. I love me some German South Park.
So you're in a foreign country and you spend your time watching American reruns in a language you can't even understand.
Dude, we create all of the entertainment
around the
globe.
It's like they're just getting Seinfeld in some places over there and they're loving it.
you turn on television. We were in Austria. We were in Germany. You turn on television over there. They have just discovered Judge Wapner.
Judge Wapner.
Yeah, there's all these like rip-offs of those court shows.
Yeah,
are huge. And like American Idol-ish stuff, which, to be fair, that sort of came from
right.
from England. But and then every cartoon we've ever done, ever, Wile E. Coyote, he speaks German.
Yeah,
they don't. The only thing they create over there is Nazis and hate.
Yeah. All right.
So why aren't anybody sitting in the chair that Patrice used to sit in?
Oh, you're going to mention that, huh? I don't know. Where is Patrice tonight?
Probably doing comedy. Jim Florentine's calling in on the show tonight. We've
what
also
do you think
got,
he's doing? The web junk?
We've also got comedian Rob Paravonian. Wayne's not a real big...
This is another feud.
I love Patrice. Like,
dude,
I love Patrice. I think he's hilarious.
You hung out with him backstage at O&A?
I think his comedy is... But he does that web junk, and it's terrible. And has anybody here told him it's terrible?
What web junk are you talking
about? Come on, have you seen it? Be quiet.
Come on, E-Rod.
Wow.
Have you seen it? Is it bad?
Nobody's going to go on record.
Right. Dude,
the New York Times wrote it up and loved it.
Did they?
Wait, what are you talking about? What web junk?
You never seen the show?
He kind of like goes over like, you know, like how every week there's like something that went on the web, you know, like, you know, a bull, you know, during the bull run just mutilating a guy. Mm-hmm. And he kind of comments on it, you know, but it's like, it's not funny. I didn't find it funny.
Man, you're like 50 Cent up in
Steve
food.
The Trucker.
Yeah. Hey,
it's not. Come on.
How long do you want to do your show on OA show?
What are you referring to?
This must be like your final time on the show because you just used the bullhorn and you know that's sacred to Anthony.
Well, first off, Anthony and I are friends and I'm smart enough to never use anything of Anthony's and to keep a good perimeter away from him so I don't give him germs. Why would I use this fucking bullhorn, dude? It's the same bullhorn that I had on the K-Rock show.
Oh, I was just checking.
Dude,
I just wanted to make sure.
Listen, I'm not retarded. I'm not suicidal. This one's even got the fucking siren on it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
Which Anthony used to have the siren, and then didn't Anthony throw his...
He had to break it.
He broke it.
Who was using it? E-Rock? I think he was doing imitations of those guys?
Oh, some interns. We're touching it. Well, see, my problem with this one is I had to take the batteries out because I was on the railroad coming in, and in my bag, this went off. And, like, the fucking train starts to evacuate, and there's police, and it was a bad scene. But thanks for looking out for me, dude.
Hey, I know why Lady Trucker says that Japanese guys have small dicks.
Why?
Because her fucking box is too big.
Trucker war!
Yeah, right. Dude, we haven't had a good trucker TV show in a while.
We have not.
What happened to just riding around the country, you with a stick in your hand and a monkey in the passenger seat? What happened to that?
We need to pitch that, dude.
I think so.
Mm.
Jim Florentine's calling in later with a TV show idea.
Really?
That involves somebody in this room that I will not mention. But one last thing on the anime was Reed and I were talking about the English websites. Like,
the
Japanese are so fascinated with the English language that they have T-shirts over there that just have random American words on it. Like that one, fuck off the police.
Yeah, right. I saw some guy, he was wearing, this was in Germany though, but he was wearing a leather jacket and he was like all hard. He looked like Wayne a little bit, you know, with a big beard, and he was trying to be all hard, but on the back of his leather jacket he had handwritten, "Fuck off the police." It's like, yeah, boy.
Dude, I was in that Hofbrau house where Hitler used to hang out, and sure. I bought the mug for Anthony, and there was a guy behind me with sort of like a mullet, and he had a jean jacket that had a Confederate flag on the back. You know, and I hear him speaking German. I'm like, well, this is kind of a, you know, bizarre vibe. And you can't wear a swastika over there. You're not allowed to have a swastika.
That's probably a good idea.
Your, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So he just went with the Southern flag?
So I tapped him and I said, hey, you know, where did you get that? You know, I'm sort of from the South in America, and it's kind of weird to see a German wearing it. And I'm like, what's that for? And he goes, rock and roll.
Skinner fan?
Yeah, it's a rebel.
Evidently so.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Before the show, Reed was reading, what is this bizarre Korean porn magazine?
Korean.
I think it's Japanese, you know, but I knew we were going to have a theme going on tonight with weird porn, and this is something my boy brought me back from, I guess he got it in Hong Kong, but it looks Japanese, and it's basically a porn magazine, but just like we were talking about, for some reason, even though it's only distributed in Japan and it's only for Japanese people, they feel the need to like fill these pages with just nonsense English that nobody bothers to translate and clearly means nothing. Like, you want me to read you a little bit, Lazlo?
Hit it.
All right. Here's the headline. Fucking slut and slavish occupation. What is the indecent occupation a masochist man is under an illusion? An occupation? It is considered to be a female doctor and a female teacher. A man feels pleasure and insult for the occupation woman of an act who receives this almsgiving and swells illusion. Please look at the substance with the occupation women were hidden.
So I gotta tell you, I lose an erection just reading that.
Why is that even in there? Dude, and I love on the cover.
Why are you reading it?
Well, that's what fascinated me about this thing. But this magazine is called Eriko, and on the cover in big letters it says, "Get up, please fuck erotic goddess."
I found a Japanese magazine named Eriko.
Eureka, I don't
Eureka,
know how you pronounce
it. However, it just doesn't seem real.
Scuba from Montana.
Hey, Lazlo, love the show.
Why are you named after a diving?
Because I'm an diver that lives in Montana, unfortunately.
I see. What's up, man?
Right by the water.
Hey, there's nothing nastier than that enema stuff.
You like it?
Dude, I'm with you. These guys want me to watch this fucking video. I ain't down.
Who wants to watch a bunch of brown water splash all over somebody?
Is it brown?
Oh, it's paint.
Dude, it's blue. Brown, some of it is chunks. It's not just liquid. It's like a... high colonic.
Well, and you've got these nasty chicks that have their asses violated by monsters or something. I mean,
there was no monsters. You need to watch one of these videos. There was no monsters.
He's watching some kind of Dungeons and Dragons right. Porn. You come in with a 2-damage sword.
Have you ever experienced one?
No.
Do you ever think about giving one?
No.
Okay.
Do you, Wayne?
I do occasionally now think about... getting cleaned out.
You mean with paint?
No, with a colonic, maybe. You know, a coffee colonic.
Hey, just want to tell you guys, good show, though.
Thanks, Scuba.
Scuba Steve.
Colonic. Wayne.
Great.
You paying? I'll do it for show material.
Yeah, maybe live on the air. We can...
yeah. My favorite...
You say you should have it done a couple times in your life.
My favorite thing, back to the Patrice thing, when Wayne calls me, he's like... in the midst of it, he goes, "You seen this show Web Junk with the Patrice?" He's like, "He's on here with the Stretch Armstrong."
No, that was about two. That was a different one. I was like,
I love the 80s or something.
About like the 100 weirdest toys. And, you know, he's on, he's got a Stretch Armstrong. I was like, come on, dude. You're from the ghetto. You didn't have a Stretch Armstrong. Come on.
He's coming from a guy that robbed shoe stores.
I didn't even have a Stretch Armstrong. You know, come on. Stretch Armstrong.
What toys did you have?
G.I. Joe. Mm-hmm. Then after that was a lot of sports.
And right. A box of nails.
No, I didn't get the box of nails until later on.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of sports, you know.
But you it sounds like you had an unhappy childhood, because didn't your dad leave you in the car in the bar
It was all good. You didn't know what was back then, what was good and what was bad. It was all good.
Getting locked in a car all day where
you
your dad goes
locked.
To the bar.
You weren't locked. Like, then the window's closed and it's 100 degrees and you got a black roof, you know? The windows were open. He gave you the keys to the radio.
Luxury.
The keys to the radio.
Well, turned on the ignition to let you turn the radio on.
I was unaware that would... Would you have a Victrola in the back of the trunk?
Yeah.
Was this 1802?
It was early on.
What were you listening to?
It was still AM radios in the car, just so you know.
The Allies have won again!
Let's bring the dandies back home.
Hey.
This is the Lazlow Show. Coming up in a bit, we've got comedian Rob Paravonian that's going to come on, and I believe he's going to have a guitar.
He may.
Correct? And I bought some hip-hop, some Nazi hip-hop in Germany that we will play. We've got some propaganda videos, speaking of the 40s, the videos that they made Wayne watch in school.
Mm.
We'll be back in just a bit.
For kids is driving parents and entire neighborhoods crazy.
The Lazlow Show.
There are places on Long Island where men go to hook up with other men. Mm-hmm. The Field 6 parking lot at Jones Beach.
I was just there yesterday morning at 6 o'clock in the morning. That's amazing.
Big Wayne.
A rest stop near exit 52 on the Long Island.
Oh, I know that one. Hold on. That's called Pickle Park.
And...
if you need to get around New York City, a scooter is the way to go.
Producer Reed Tucker.
You know what? I'm gonna bring in my registration papers, because technically, according to the state of New York, it is a motorcycle.
A motorcycle that's not that can't go over 35 miles an hour.
A motorcycle with streamers on the handlebars.
Big Daddy. Donation to the Natty Negro Pizza Fund.
And what's that?
That's a donation for pizza and beer for Negro.
The Lazlow Show.
All right, episode 24, like super. I'd call it like a superhero episode, but you know, superheroes now trademarked. Did you know that?
I heard that. You cannot use the word superhero.
DC and Marvel trademarked it together. You can't even like call a comic book a superhero comic book because those fools will sue you.
What do you gotta call like? Specially powered, you know, individuals?
Or science heroes.
Science heroes. I like science heroes.
But, you know, if they could focus on not fucking up every good comic book that I enjoy when they turn it into a movie, name one comic book that has been successfully turned into a movie.
Superman 1 and 2.
Okay. Okay. Fair enough, sir.
Batman Begins.
Okay.
X-Men 2.
Okay.
Look at Reed.
Booyah.
But, dude, everything else, suckage.
Pretty much.
Daredevil?
Awful.
Right. Fantastic Four?
Awful.
Correct.
But I thought you didn't see movies. You don't leave your house.
Oh, you know what I do is I read the reviews, and then I don't have to, and I just make a decision.
Just like
I'm like the Reverend Al Sharpton. I don't have to see what offends me. Somebody tells me I should be offended by it, and then I'm offended by it.
Mm-hmm.
I like that.
Well.
Speaking of the Reverend Al Sharpton, somebody... I was on the phone with today who espouses himself to be Mr. Straight and Narrow and doesn't like ever exhibit any kind of racism, was invited to lunch above 96th Street in Manhattan and said that he doesn't go up there because it's a little darker.
Mm.
That's not what I said. I just said it was too far for me to go.
You're one of the guys that should definitely not go to Jamaica if you're intimidated by the color.
Look at me. I look like Ron Howard, dude. I'm going to get shivved.
Right.
I'm the first person.
Dude, they will respect you much more for walking through the neighborhood.
You look like a bad science fiction clone
of my boy Bill Burr.
I know, exactly. But Bill Burr, is, he comes a little stronger than me. You know?
Right.
He's
not too much stronger. He had a fake Izod on the last time we seen him.
That's true. He did have a fake Izod when
Knock
he came
off.
In.
That's true. But he uses it to his advantage, you know. He makes it kind of funny.
How do you?
I just didn't make it gay. But I did, excuse me, so bite me, dude. But
you are a nasty sissy!
Great. You just have that loaded up anytime I'm going to say something.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. But I was up in at the Apollo Theater in Harlem the other day, which is...
How
was
that place?
Excuse me, 125th Street. Yeah, it's nice. You ever been?
No.
You got to go for amateur night, dude. It's hot.
Really? What do they do?
Just have a bunch of amateur acts.
Are there gunfights and shit?
Man.
Listen, I saw Eddie Murphy raw. I know how this goes down.
No, the Apollo's fine. But the
outside the Apollo, you have to worry.
Yeah, we were walking up there, and we were walking. Some guy walked by us, and he was like, "Hope you like Harlem."
Like, well, yeah, not anymore.
Yeah, I know. Thank you. I'll be running to my car now. But we went to see the Gorillaz, you know, the cartoon band that's... They're like a cartoon, but they have real people anyway.
Speaking of, we've got a Jaguar Skills episode brand new.
He's actually a cartoon, yeah.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Will be played tonight. For fans of Jaguar Skills, we got lots of emails. People said, what happened to Jaguar Skills? There's a new episode this evening.
And what happens is it takes 1,100 hours to make 2 minutes of radio for you.
We had... this show almost didn't happen.
I know.
I'm sitting there. I've got all the production, everything on the mothership in the Radio Lazlow studios. And I'll be damned if a transformer didn't blow up and catch on fire and it all went dark. And I'm calling Wayne because he fixes things. I'm like, you got a generator? No.
He doesn't fix things on the weekends.
Right.
We've already gone over this.
I was going to have to like physically take my computer somewhere to get everything off the hard drive for the show.
Mm.
It was a bad scene.
But it all worked out.
So you're up at the Apollo.
Yeah, right.
What did we learn by this? You're going to maybe go out and buy a generator now?
Maybe.
Yeah, $300 and you're hooked up.
And what's retarded, my entire roof is covered in solar panels.
That is what's retarded.
That's what's the most retarded component.
Wait, did those
of
shut down the whole thing?
You get tons of money from the government. If you want solar panels, wind, and, you know, get off the, you know, Saudi dole, I'll leave it at that. And there's free money from the government to do
free
that.
Money.
Free money. Like, we got over $30,000 to do this, right? Free. So, but the power company, because they don't want you ever officially off the teat.
Which refers to what?
Their juice.
They used to refer to it as the teat.
The teat.
Meaning like a nipple?
What?
How old are you?
What was the last?
I don't understand where that came from.
What was the last grade that you finished?
Eighth.
Thank you.
We said finished.
Right. Right. Not banged a chick in the back of a burnt out bus.
I just never heard that, like, you know, a tit and electricity put together. You know?
I'm surprised it's not in one of your Joe Gallant videos.
Oh, man. You're confusing him. All right, but go on. So you got solar panels.
Well, so they make it so that if the power goes out, you go out. So, they want you tied into the system. I don't know. It's a whole conspiracy. I'm going to read about it. Me and that 9/11 fool.
I would think there's some way you could bypass it, without a doubt.
So, you're up in Harlem.
So, we're seeing the Gorillaz, who are pretty sweet,
the, outside the,
no,
establishment? You meant the band.
I'm not even going to address that.
Correct.
No, but they had a lot of guest stars, you know, that who play on their album, and one of the guest stars they trotted out was Ike Turner.
Now, did people know? Like, did they say, "Here comes Ike"?
No, that's the thing.
You bitches better run.
It's so weird because
fuck you up, boy.
Dude looked like Apollo Creed out of Rocky II, man. He had like this yellow sequin suit on, but nobody knew who he was because they didn't say who these guest stars were. You know, it was up to you to figure out. And they had a program.
I hate it when they do that.
I know.
Like,
everyone...
I saw G Love, and he started bringing people out. And I'm like, I would love to know who you're bringing out.
Exactly.
You know, don't pull that, you know, if you're cool, you'll know.
I know, and you go home, and you're talking with your friends in the car, and you were like, damn, Jay-Z was hot. And they're like, what the hell are you talking about? I don't know Jay-Z there.
Dumb shit,
like,
that was Arnold.
Right.
Different strokes.
I know, exactly.
How high were you
that
at this
Mariah
show?
Mariah Carey. But, you know, we figured out it was Ike Turner, and it was weird because nobody quite knew, but when they bring out a guest star, everyone starts to cheer, sort of just, it's just a reaction, it's like Pavlovian, and so everyone's clapping for Ike Turner, and then you see the women, like, in the crowd just start to go, you know, oh, shit, wait, hang on, I'm not gonna,
and they start, like, smacking, right,
so they start, like, smacking each other, don't clap for that mofo!
Right.
So it was, It was quite an experience. But he came out, and he played like classical piano. Did you know Ike Turner could play classical piano? He played like a minute of classical piano, and that was it. Rolled out.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So what did he do? He busted out a little Mozart, smoked some crack, and then beat a bitch up in the front row and said, I'm out.
Yep. Smashed a bottle down and stole a car.
Dude,
it was good.
How I was, you know, we were talking about this earlier. How bad did he beat her up?
You know, I don't know because I never saw that movie. What was the Tina Turner movie? It was What's Love Got to Do with It? But apparently, it's pretty bad.
What, Tina Turner?
Yeah, he beat up Tina Turner
pretty bad.
I think I don't know. I never saw that movie, but
I can't comment on it. I don't know
what
she might have needed to be slapped around though.
Wayne, you've always said.
Yes,
never beat a woman.
True. That's true.
In public,
right? I'm just doing it for the comedic value.
You used to have a little bit of an issue.
I had a problem with my hands, yes. I tried to tell you guys at dinner.
I didn't want to hear it.
Yeah.
Because you're such a kind... Everybody thinks you're such a kind, honest
yeah,
dude.
Yeah, I had a little period in my life where my hands, you know, reacted before my brain thought.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And?
You have to learn to control yourself.
Really?
I learned to control myself.
Were you listening to Ike?
No, I wasn't listening to Ike. I listened to my inner self.
And did the girls come back after that?
It was only one, no.
She never came back?
Nope, that's the homeless girl.
Oh,
here we go. Hold on a second.
Start the sad music, dude.
Start the sad music.
Let me get this straight. Not only did you, like,
yes,
a woman, her house burned down. She's living in a car.
Yes, and then what do I do?
You bring her home to fuck her.
You treated your ladies right.
You got to keep them in line.
There you go.
And then when she got mouthy...
No, it wasn't necessarily that she was mouthy. No,
she just
I would get
rubbed
jealous.
In the wrong way.
I would get jealous over different situations and that, and I would react with my hands first before I would with my brain.
See, we need some more documentary.
And you believe me, you feel guilty the minute you do it. You know what you did is wrong.
But maybe your brain tells you.
Yes.
Do it. Do it. Smack that bitch down.
Yep.
She got saggy titties anyway.
No, she didn't.
No, she didn't. They were nice. We saw them on the video.
She had nice titties anyway.
Reed might have fantasized to that video one time, Matt.
Probably fucking your best friend.
That's what was going through my mind, sure.
But was that true? Was she?
No.
Okay.
No, but, you know.
But you better, just to be safe.
Right, you gotta slap them around and keep them in line just in case.
Well, but you know, if you're a jealous type, you date a homeless girl because her options are sort of limited. You know, there aren't that many guys she can get.
Do you think
right.
so? Huh?
Well, I don't know,
dude. Seriously, I mean, she's homeless. That does sort of like work against
right.
you.
There aren't so many guys that you can take back to the car. You know, who are willing
exactly.
to go.
Exactly. So you know, you want to be able to bring a girl home and like, oh, so you know, where does she live? You know, around here?
Yeah, right.
She moves around a lot. What does she smell like in Exxon station? She lets me pop her in the ass, Dad. I'll be honest with you. Good job, son.
Oh,
dude,
man.
Dude, there's a fool who has been on hold for literally an hour.
All right, let's check him out.
What's he got to say?
Jimmy from Boston.
Hey, Jim.
Lazlow, what's going on, man?
Dude, you have been literally this little timer thing says you were on hold for an hour.
Yeah, I know. It's just because, like, you're the only reason I play Grand Theft Auto. So I just, like, wanted to talk to you. You're, like, my fucking idol, man.
Are you over 18, sir?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
So the game quality sucks. It's just because Lazlow's in it.
Well, Grand Theft Auto 3 was pretty good, but, yeah.
Pretty good. Best-selling game ever.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, I just wanted to say, everybody on FullBlownAIDS.com is hoping that you get a golden ticket for your show tonight, man.
High praise indeed, FullBlownAIDS.com. Are you one of the webmasters, or...?
No, just a regular.
Just a regular on FullBlownAIDS.
Red belly.
You know, Reed showed us he's got a little thing on his arm. He got an AIDS test recently.
Uh-oh.
So now he's got that little period in between where you think about every skanky munching you did on that old nasty hoochie.
Yeah, but he only had like two. So it can't be that. Why were you even tested two?
Well, you know, you're at the doctor and he's taking blood and he throws it in for free. You know, you got insurance.
What, do you lie and tell him a different number? I've had 28 sexual partners.
Thanks, Jimmy.
He didn't ask. It was true, though. You know, it's no matter how many or how few, you're always thinking, like, there's always that horrible week where you're like, God damn, what did I do?
Reed, what is your number? Because the whole last program, you got around this, and tonight we still didn't. Say a number.
What did you tell what did you tell your ex-girlfriend? You gave her a range, didn't you?
I gave her a range.
And what would that range be?
I said the range was... now I get sad music with it? Why don't I get happy music with it?
Because there's no happy music in life, Reed.
especially when you broke up with a girl because you're so goddamn hard-headed that you won't tell her how many chicks you fucked. Who cares?
Right. Well,
I care. It's poison, Lazlo. It's poison. No, I said the range was more than 10 and less than 20.
You fag. You couldn't hang around with regular guys every day.
Dude,
if you come with that answer,
look, man,
you got no respect.
I'm not even saying that's the true answer. I'm saying that's all I said.
You are a nasty sissy.
I don't think there's even 10. 10 guys.
That's what I'm saying.
Have you had an AIDS test before?
Yes.
It is the worst.
It is the worst.
My, like, a couple AIDS tests ago, and by that I mean 3 weeks ago. I haven't had one in years, but I had a couple. What do you mean, dude? You never know when you can get it.
What are you getting it from, a toilet seat?
Mosquitoes.
Mosquitoes.
I'm gonna that shit that went around in the 80s. Do you remember that?
Yes,
people were bugging. Yeah, they're like,
I know.
Oh, dude, talking about. See, homosexuals had a little bit of protection back then because what are you doing?
I'm opening another can of beer, but they make so many noise and I can't help it.
Because people, you wouldn't drag a fag behind your truck in the 80s because you'd be afraid you'd catch the hip. A little bit of protection. Am I right?
They didn't drag a fag behind the pickup truck, just so you know.
There were AIDS victims, literally, that like doctor hospitals wouldn't even touch them because there was so much misconceptions about, you know, where the disease came from. Rob Paravonian sitting out there. Looks
you
very,
been tested?
He looks very funny.
He looks horrified. yeah. But we should talk about your medical news, Lazlo.
Oh, yeah, I almost died.
Oh, there was that.
Yeah, in fact, I was supposed to go to the big ONA party there for St. Patrick's Day. But I caught like some kind of Nazi bird flu over in Germany that week, and it was like things were going okay, and then I woke up one morning and felt awful, and I was like, okay, this will be okay, you know, I've been partying a lot, and then I started coughing up blood.
Wow.
And I was like, this ain't a good sign. And I was in Budapest at that point. And
you don't want to go to a doctor in
Budapest. You ever been in Budapest?
Yeah, they treat you with a leech.
Yeah, I was just there last week.
Oh, dude, you ain't...
What the hell am I doing
there? You haven't even left Long Island in 4 years.
Dude, all the buildings are shot up.
You've been?
Yeah, I've been.
The place,
really?
I have, dude.
What?
The place looks like the Nazis and the Soviets just got finished blowing that shit up 2 weeks ago.
So they did.
The place is beat down. I was like, I am not going to a doctor here.
No.
So I come back and I get like I get a chest X-ray, and they're like, oh, you got pneumonia. And I'm like, don't only like old people get pneumonia? How do I get pneumonia? And then I joke. I'm like, so I don't have lung cancer. You know, because I've been known to smoke anything that I can. And the guy's like, yeah, there's, you know, you got the, it's a Jewish doctor, you got something on there, I can't figure out what it is, but your regular doctor will call you on Monday about it. And I'm like, are you kidding me? You're going to let me sit here all weekend and try to figure out if I'm going to die?
That sucks.
Dude, it stunk.
So did your life flash before your eyes? You know how they say that? When you get the bad news, you start to think your regrets.
You know, and I sort of went into that, like, weird slow-mo mode. I started pushing everybody away.
Really?
Yeah, you know, because, I mean, when you're sort of in that space of, you know, could I die, you're just kind of like a man against the elements. You know what I mean?
Like, sort of. I would think it would draw you closer. Come on,
you just
kind
of like you're standing on a hilltop... Thinking about all the things that you've done, all the things and dumb decisions you made, that chick in high school that wanted to blow me and I didn't let her because I was a Christian at that point.
That's true.
See, you know what, though? You... See, it's cool now we're doing the show and you can say all that cool stuff, but when you called me and you told me that your life flashed before your eyes, and did he tell you
he
this
was teared up a little, yes.
No, I did, dude, not tear
he
up.
Did not,
you were a little emotional.
You can be emotional, but
I blew it off. I said, yeah, I'm going to die, fool.
Screw you, cancer. Check it out, though. This is 100% truth. Tell me this is not a lie, dude, that you said that when your life flashed before your eyes, all this that you thought about your entire life, and the one thing that you regretted most was the amount of hours you had spent juicing. That's what you said.
Well, dude, listen, at this young age, I mean, you hear about those people that die of, like, lung cancer at, like, you know, and they never smoked.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, through their head, they're like, I could have been enjoying a nice Marlboro cigarette every morning, every night. If this is the way I'm going to go,
that's true.
Then why didn't I just smoke in the first place?
But you know, that's true. But most people, they get that bad news. They get the picture of, you know, oh, that hot girl I banged like 5 years ago. You got the mental image of you cramming a beet into a juicer. That's the first thing that comes to your mind.
What an amazing waste of time. I would have been drinking vodka in the morning if I knew I was going to fucking kick out.
So have you given up juicing now?
No.
Have you changed your life?
No.
Come on. You got to make some changes, dude.
I got to tell you, I haven't had a beer since. Since
really?
Lunch. No.
Why not?
Because I'm waiting a couple of weeks, dude.
Why?
Because I'm trying to clean the system out.
He does this periodically.
Right.
Well, I know.
Builds up too high of a tolerance.
I got to tell you, I can drink a case of beer right now. Like, I brought a case of beer in here for the fellas.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Could be the reason that the pad data was fucked up for half an hour.
Which Wayne has helped himself to, clearly.
What? The
all
beer.
The beers, yeah.
Correct. My tolerance is ridiculous.
But you do know that beer doesn't cause lung cancer, don't you?
No.
I'm pretty sure it does something else to the liver.
Right. Oh. Phil.
Yo.
What's your question?
I was wondering, is that Reed Tucker from Grand Theft Auto 3 on the air with you?
No, it's not.
No?
Nope.
About the same guy?
That's different.
Ah.
Thanks, man.
People are so... People like video games.
People are dense, too.
Why do...
Fred in New York says he's got AIDS. Fred? Fred.
That's Fred.
Fred.
Brett.
Oh, Brett.
Brett.
Well, I'm sorry. Our lovely staff of Than and Danny are shit-faced.
No, they're always cops as usual.
Okay. What do you mean they're always cocks as usual?
No, tops.
Tops. Okay. Easy.
Awesome. We got a problem with this guy's consonants.
Right.
No, tops. How about a cell phone? What happened was I got an AIDS test, and it was at my girlfriend's, where she worked. It was a doctor's office.
Wait, your girlfriend worked at a doctor's office, and you're getting an AIDS test there.
Yeah.
Didn't you think to try to go somewhere else? Because you have
I
to fill that form
it.
Out. Did you ever have to fill the form out where you have to put, like, the last few people that you slept with?
No, what happened was it was easier to do it there because I didn't have insurance.
So you got a free AIDS test.
Yeah, exactly.
But was it important? Did you need one?
Oh, definitely. So I had it done there, and then what happened was... I broke up with her, and then apparently she decided to...
She changed the data in the computer. Please tell me she changed the data.
She did.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
No way. That is not cool.
Yeah, so I come in there, talk to the doctor, and apparently she decides that she changes the data around, and I get something back where my test results come back where I'm positive. Which is not good at all.
I would think so. The HIV is a bit of a downer, bro.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so when you found this out, what did you do?
Well, I'm talking to a doctor, and I talked to him, and I said, you know, obviously, is this definite? And he says, you know, these are obviously your blood results. So I told him, I go, you know, I've had some, you know, mishaps in the past. You know,
now, when you say mishaps, sir, does it involve another man's ass?
No, yeah. It was that easy.
Were you a receiver or a hitter?
No, yeah, it was that easy.
You said, which one?
I don't expect it, you know?
What do you mean you don't expect it? To get popped in the ass?
No, at least I would expect it if I was, you know, pulling cock into my ass.
Uh-huh. But do you have your radio on?
No, I don't think so.
Okay,
no.
There's a little bit of an echo.
Really?
All right. So what did you do? Get a second opinion?
No, so I finally talked to him, and then I came back, and I got another test done. And we've already been broken up at this point. So I get another test done, and I go back to him finally, and I get the results. This is probably a two-week time span, and I'm talking to her in between, and she's telling me this is why we broke up. I don't know if she did it on purpose, this way she could break up with me, but, you know, that's what happens. I don't know.
Okay.
Fucking sluts.
Yeah, like you weren't trying to be a weasel to get a free blood test.
Right. Yeah. That's what you get for a free AIDS test, fool.
I wish it was that easy.
Okay, so are you still together with her?
No, not after that.
Yeah, right.
Was she worth it?
Well, I mean, she did, she was at all three inputs, if that what you call it.
Interesting.
Yeah.
You mm-hmm. fucked her in the ear.
Did she ever do a paint enema?
What she used to like to do was rodeos.
I love the rodeo.
Okay, so are you still together with her?
Dude, right. You do have your radio on. What a jackass.
All right.
What?
All right. Good night.
That's it?
I'm like, do you have your radio on? And you would ask him a question, and he'd be like, so, do you have AIDS? Yes. It's like, da-da-da. And then he would, like, go on to say that he doesn't have AIDS.
Oh, yeah.
Do you have your radio on? No. And then I hear myself in the background.
I knew I heard something. I wasn't quite sure what it was.
We should bring Rob Paravonian in. He was on our old K-Rock show. Look at this, Reed. You don't even have to go get the guest.
I can't. I know.
It's pretty legit.
Cool.
I gotta say.
He got no technical skills anymore.
He was on our... he was on our K-Rock show. I'm pushing this button that says Ben.
And he has a video camera.
Why?
Somebody's gonna...
Oh, I'll do that one.
What's the video camera for, dude?
It's, you know, there's a court order and it's a house arrest thing, you know how it goes. So I gotta prove that I'm working tonight.
What did you do? And please tell me that is not a pocket protector.
No, you know, it's just it's a notebook, but I actually looked online to find pocket protectors, and there's only one place that sells them. You can't
still makes them?
Yeah, and it's almost just like one guy who still believes in the pocket protector, and he started a website just to sell them.
Well, you know those HP calculators that, like, all the scientist geeks use? If you go on eBay, people are paying, like, hundreds of dollars for calculators from, like, the 1980s.
Where they don't make them anymore?
I don't know. They still make them, but they're more sophisticated, and I don't know.
They don't have that retro chic.
Yeah, right.
It's kind of cool to carry a calculator around you in case you need to figure out if there's a fusion reaction about to go down or something. So you've been on college tours again, or?
Yeah, I don't mean to brag, but I've been to Southern Indiana.
Wow.
Very exciting.
I was in Indiana one time.
Yeah?
I got on the wrong train in Chicago, and I'm like, hey, so the next stop is the convention center. They're like, no, the next
what
stop.
What part of Indiana were you in?
I was in Vincennes, Indiana. Southern. Yeah.
There's no show.
Don't worry about me over here.
That's irrelevant. I want to know what part.
He's just going to run things from now on.
He heard convention center, and he wanted to bail out.
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
Bird Dog the Trucker, you got something to clean out my system?
Yeah, I do.
It's not your caucus.
It might sound like a shameless plug, but you like chocolate.
Do I like chocolate? Why, yes, I do, sir. Usually at 2 in the morning.
Okay. Actually, I've got something called Showside Chocolate. If you take 2 tablespoons a day, 3 times a day, you'll feel better within 3 days.
What's it called? Sexual chocolate?
Showside. Showside. It's spelled X-O-C-A-I.
That is not a word.
Right.
Whatever. He just made something up.
He spelled it out some chapter in Narnia or something.
Yeah, you get it from the planet Reglak.
Exactly.
How many silent letters were in there, man? It's like
there's a schwa E on the last syllable.
It starts with the pi sign.
You whip out your HP calculator and get the cube root of infinity.
And then you have to turn it upside down to read it.
Exactly.
That sounds like some. You ever been to like a pharmacy down in Chinatown and they have all those weird canisters?
Really? What are you doing down there? He's down there getting some rhino horn.
That's really, they have that stuff,
like,
you know?
Girl broke like, up with. Do they really have rhino horn down there?
Some of it's supposed to be like an aphrodisiac.
You know what?
Tiger penis they have.
What is with those people? If there's an endangered animal, they will take the cock of it and grind it up and snort it.
It's good eating.
Yeah. There's something called bird's nest, too, which is like a real delicacy. It's like a really expensive stuff that they put in food, and it's basically swallow vomit. This certain type of bird that's very prized. Well, I swear this is totally true, dude. They
how
vomit.
Much time do you spend in Chinatown anyway? What do you go down there?
I'm manga shopping down there.
Exactly. What?
No, these guys have to climb these cliffs to scrape this vomit off these cliffs to collect it, and like one out of every 3 guys dies. That's why it's so expensive. That's totally true.
How much is it?
That is a lot. They have it behind the counter.
Like, we used to have, like, either Than or E-Rock would sit next to us in here, like, you know, to help us.
They don't care.
They don't give a shit.
No.
Go on. Just split.
Maybe we should offer Rob some of our manga porn.
Yeah, we've got manga porn, Rob.
E-Rock, how come you're not drinking any beer?
Yikes.
Working.
Because you're working? Well, then, how come the rest of these... Oh, he's... What? He has a vagina, is what Than is somehow learning sign language in there. So, Reed sent me, speaking of Asians, which seems to be the overriding theme, we might as well just call this the Hing Hong fucking comedy hour. Reed kept sending me all this stuff on YouTube. I know, Wayne, you've never been to YouTube. Rob, you've been to YouTube?
I've seen, yeah, people links, yeah.
It, like, most of the stuff on there seems to be people, like, lip-syncing power ballads in their, in their bedroom.
I know.
It is, and there's a lot of, like, Asian guys lip-syncing power ballads.
Mm-hmm, with their shirts unbuttoned. And those are, like, some of the most popular clips, which I don't get.
I know, they're always at the top.
I couldn't decide if it was a joke or they were trying to get chicks.
You
what
know,
do you think?
And Reed and I used to work at an ad agency, and I don't know if you've ever worked in sort of the advertising field, the soulless, but, like, these ad agencies will cling on to anything, and their big vibe now is they're like, we really want to get into this viral marketing. And Reed still writes for some ad agencies, and I have a few of them every now and then that I'll write commercials for, but I had this one, like, a few weeks ago that for a soup company, and they said, and they had, like, a millions of dollars. Like, we want to create a viral marketing campaign, stuff that's really funny to get passed around the internet. And I'm like, here's the deal. Whatever sort of corporate horse shit you put together is not going to get passed around the internet from office to office.
No.
You know, if somebody's like dropping Campbell's soup cans over an overpass at a gay pride parade and knocking fools out,
right,
that will get passed around. You'll get a little logo and brand recognition from that. Reed and I used to sit in these meetings that were soul-crushing.
It was just... I mean, these people started to believe things that just were not true. You know, these commercials were so bad.
People always ask where bad TV commercials come from. Like, why is TV advertising so bad?
From us. It's all our fault.
Reed and I were... We would write, like, good radio commercials and good TV commercials, and once it got through that sort of corporate mill...
Mm-hmm.
It came out the other side some kind of lily-white garbage.
Mm-hmm.
My favorite was TGI Fridays. Do you remember that client?
Yeah, but in their defense, there is no good commercial for TGI Fridays, I don't think. But damn it, we didn't give it a try. I do remember that.
I wrote these commercials for TGI Fridays. They had, like, these frozen drinks that, you know, when you're working at an office after work, you take some office friends there, you get shit-faced, and then you fuck your assistant. and so they've got these, like, foo-foo drink mixes and stuff. And so we wrote these commercials that were very funny. And we're on this conference call with these people that are in Texas, which I don't know why the center of the business universe is now run out of a place that didn't even want to be part of fucking America in the first place. But, like, dealing with Texas business people drives me bananas. These people on the phone, they're like, well, that's really funny. Those are good commercials, but we're a Christian company. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me?
They said that?
You got people wearing some kind of zoo outfits, like at a circus with a bunch of bullshit buttons,
right,
shoving foo-foo drinks and jalapeno poppers down people's faces.
Right, and the product
was... Where's that Deuteronomy? Right. Can you explain to me where the jalapeno poppers comes in?
Exactly.
Ecclesiastes, I think.
Is it?
Yeah. Yeah, the strawberry-flavored vodka. Where's that in the whole Christian canon?
Paul in Wisconsin's got a chemical that can clear us up. Paul.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
you just got us riveted, brother.
Right.
He's like, yes, I do. I'm not going to tell you what
he's
it
got
is.
A chemical that can clear us up. It's called boredom. Paul.
Yeah, I got a great way to... cleanse your body, man.
All right.
It's called clothes, Lazlow. I'm naked!
Wow. That was a throwback to something that there's a few people that got. That's just like on our last K-Rock show, somebody called in and said, Ramon! Reed Tucker has AIDS! And Reed had this look on his face. He'd never heard of Ramon. He had no clue. Still don't know, do you?
No.
You ever heard of Ramon?
No.
You'll hear from him.
But that is how he found out he had AIDS, which is
right. That's where I got the test.
How long ago was the test?
Yesterday.
Really?
Yeah.
Sweating?
No.
Is there a new chick involved or something? A new guy that you went to get the test?
Dude, I went. I told you this. I went to get it. I went to the doctor, and he does blood work, and it's part of the blood work. That's it.
He didn't just go in there and say, I woke up. Here, this is, I love Reed to death. He's a great friend. But he calls me, like, a couple weeks ago, and I'm like, hey, man, how's it going? He's like, man, I woke up this morning, and I went, and I looked out on my fire escape by my, was it kitchen or bathroom?
My living room.
But I looked out on my fire escape, and there's a jar of Vaseline and a bottle of Mrs. Dash. And I'm like, well, does your fucking ass feel spicy?
Yeah, I don't know what was going on. I'm on a fire, well, my fire escape. Those two things do not go together at all.
Have you touched them?
Oh, I threw them away.
Did they, I mean, do you afraid that maybe you were sleepwalking?
No, this didn't come from me, man. Somebody was having a party on the fire escape doing God knows what.
At what point are you like going?
You need Mrs. Dash. It's like I got Vaseline. I don't know where Mrs. Dash came from. Right.
It's just not grainy enough.
Right. Oh, no, you know, maybe if you're with an ethnic person, they like it a little spicy.
I guess, but you know, now that we've seen those videos that Wayne was talking about, there's really nothing off limits or that would surprise me anymore. Anything. Anything goes, even Mrs. Dash up your cooter.
Mrs. Dash up your cooter.
The powdered enema.
Who uses Mrs. Dash anyway? I've never had a recipe. What is that shit anyway?
I don't know.
Isn't it like just a combination of simple seasonings?
I believe so.
I don't know. If maybe we could get somebody to call 866-WOW-1-WOW
with the ingredients.
With the Mrs. Dash hotline.
They probably will, and they'll probably be a trucker.
Right, exactly. And they'll probably scream, Ramon. We should get to this Arnold stuff. Reed and I are huge Arnold fans, and how we came across this was we were talking about actors and how it always seems like a really good idea at the time to hire somebody that pretends to be somebody as a politician, and then it's like, oh, wow, just because they were in a movie that I liked may not have been so great of an idea, because Arnold's, like, rating in California is, like, 10 or something.
Yeah.
It's worse than Bush's. And so we started poking around on the net. The fact that this guy got elected with the shit that is on the internet about him.
It's truly unbelievable. And even, like, in local races, you know how they just do this, like, total just hatchet job on these local candidates and dig up all the stuff from their past, you know, every little thing that they've done. And then this stuff is floating around on the internet, and Arnold Schwarzenegger still gets arrested? I mean, elected? Have you guys seen this? What, you think it's from the 70s, probably, Lazlow?
Yeah, it's like he did this.
It must be from the late 70s.
Yeah, somebody hired him to do a tourism video for Rio.
During Carnival.
Right.
Oh, and you know how that was one of the things that the Republicans were really trying to rail against when he was getting elected, was that he was sort of like this womanizing a-hole, you know, who sort of objectified women. And the Republicans are genius, because that just all went away, even though all I had to do was just look around the internet and I found this, and I could not believe.
Yeah, so I guess what was there? Arnold got paid to go do this tourism video, and the funniest thing I have seen in ages.
Rio, one of the most beautiful cities in the world. It's hard to find more gorgeous mountains, beaches, and women anywhere. I came to Rio for Carnival. I heard a lot about it, but nothing prepared me for a non-stop 5-day party.
I wonder if he just stopped and ran off in the jungle and mowed down some indigenous people.
And that's the original music from it?
Yeah. I was just going to say,
oh my God.
Sounds like one of those like Showtime softcore porns, you know, that's on at like 2 in the morning.
No, I've never heard of those.
Prepared for a non-stop 5-day party.
Like
once a year, a whole city goes absolutely crazy. To Brazilians, especially men, the mulatto is the symbol of everything sexy and erotic.
The mulatto.
Can you say mulatto now? Is that...
I don't know. You know, was that okay to just say the mulatto? Like,
I don't know. I think no.
I like the shwoogies very much.
Especially men, the mulatto is the symbol of everything sexy and erotic. During Carnival, gorgeous mulatto bodies begin to move in ways that even a fitness expert like myself can believe.
The mulatto bodies move in ways that a fitness expert like myself can't believe.
Yeah, he's pulling a Jimmy the Greek
sort of
here.
He really is, dude. Arnold the Greek.
Like myself can believe.
The Brazilians think that the sexual part of the woman, the ass,
right.
That's not how Americans think.
No, I agree with the Brazilian point of view, but I mean, go ahead. The American thing is suppressed.
Yeah.
Yeah, right, I agree with you. I knew I had something in common with the Brazilian man.
You know something? After watching the mulattoes shake it, I can absolutely understand why Brazil is totally devoted to my favorite body part, the ass.
He's the governor of California. That did not come out in the election.
And in
that is great.
And in this video, you got to see this. It's on YouTube. in this video, the things that he is doing to these women, because they like a Mr. Universe, and they invite him up there. He starts molesting.
Right.
They clearly... Show Big Wayne there. Hit play.
Oh, yeah, there you go.
He starts molesting these women.
And they want no part of
it. Right, they want no part of it.
And, oh, man. It's crazy.
So, and then the second part of this video, which may be even... I know, and he's humping this woman on
I love
screen.
It, man. That's great. He's like, hey, Maria, come here and see this.
It's bad for elections, but it actually is great for tourism.
Right. Yeah. My penis, it changes colors like the chameleon. It uses the jungle. The second half of this video, which Reed and I were loving, he gets language lessons from a woman.
Right, he's got this woman who's following him around, who's young and hot and Brazilian, and I don't know, she's never
explained. And when you say following him around, you mean giving $5
probably
to blow him.
Probably right. So she's always there, and he's always making inappropriate comments, and at the very end, they're sitting at a restaurant table, and they're giving each other language lessons, and the thing just gets bizarre.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I was reading the instant feedback. People are telling interesting things that you've been doing with Mrs. Dash.
I like the Portuguese language because it's so romantic. It reminds me of the Italian language.
It reminds me of the Italian language.
Which I also don't know.
Right. We used to send many of our people here to hide after, you know, the war because they sort of cooked a few of the Jews. You know, a lot of the Jews in Brazil. Are the,
reminds me of the Italian language. Can you teach me a little bit about it? Some nice words like love and so.
Amor.
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 Amor. Love.
Love.
I learned one word yesterday. Punga.
The look on this woman's face, now I don't know what punga means,
but
it sounds like it means pussy.
Something like that. And even right then, the $5 was too little for her right there.
She gets this look on her face like he just said the C word.
Maybe he did.
Punga. Punga. It's good, huh? Punga. Yeah. I like punga.
I like punga.
Now. So, I teach you some English.
So explain what he does now to teach her English. Well, what does he shove in her mouth?
I think punga is actually steroids. Yeah, so they're sitting there at this table, and she's now just sort of romantically shared the Portuguese word for love. And so he returns the favor by teaching her the English word for biting. And he starts to shove a carrot in her mouth.
Yeah, E-Rock's got it on the thing.
I teach you some English. Okay?
And he bites a carrot. And then shoves it in her mouth.
Biting.
Biting.
Good. Mm. That looks good. Then the next one is, put it in again. End up biting, no? Mm. Like this.
And the next one is,
oh my good. God.
Yes.
That is fucking great, man.
Oh my God.
He starts shoving the carrot in and out of her mouth.
The governor of California right. has that made a Brazilian great. Girl right. give head to a carrot.
I love at the end, he's like, now it is time to go. I was just waiting for the fucking helicopter in the background. Now I must get to the chopper.
There was a lawsuit.
That is great.
How did he get elected? How is that not...
Seriously, with him grabbing those women, clearly molesting them.
It does explain his campaign slogan, I love punga. I had no idea what that meant before.
Right, you're like, God, I wonder what language that is.
He's trying to court the Hispanic vote or
there
something.
There was another video that's on YouTube that has him explaining why he likes to work out. This one is key.
It's as satisfying to me as coming is, you know, as having sex with a woman and coming.
So can you believe how much I am in heaven? I'm like getting the feeling of coming in the gym. I'm getting the feeling of coming at home. I'm getting the feeling of coming backstage when I pump up, when I pose out in front of 5,000 people. I get the same feeling. So I'm coming day and night.
I love it, man. That is great.
Wow.
You can't even.
I don't even have the word.
Right, you're coming.
And when you do a YouTube search, it says how many videos? 349 Arnold videos on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
Reed sent me one that he starred in a Japanese like soda commercial, and all he does, he never says a word. He just makes these weird.
He just screams the whole time, and Japanese people scream back at him.
You know how in Speed Racer, how they would be like, oh, oh. They would make all those weird noises. It's like Arnold making those noises while he's like drinking soda.
Yeah, I don't know what it was. If it was ginseng something or
where was. I think it was rhino cock ground up. And he was like, just like, made him drink it.
Weird.
Yeah, dude. YouTube, it can't be around for long. It's like the DVR. You know, the TiVo and the DVR. Opie said it before, and I've talked about it on their show. The DVR is cooked.
You think?
Dude, you used to be able to go buy a digital video recorder to record shows, pause live TV. You bought it, you put it in your house, you watched TV, you used it, done. Everybody's gone after the sleazeball TiVo model, and they want a monthly subscription fee. So you cannot really just go out and buy a digital video recorder without paying the dish company or your cable company. It's retarded. It's a hard drive inside a box that downloads a file and records shows. I don't need to pay you $10 a month. Can you tell I've been on the phone with Dish Network about this?
You just turned into my father.
You got any gripes about the school system?
And another thing.
What else you got?
The slopes.
No.
Did you see that the things that our attorney general are worried about is he's going to schools and telling them not to pirate music?
Yeah?
Yeah. The attorney general flew from Washington, D.C. to San Jose, California to speak to kids and tell them that copying songs is wrong.
Well, if they're paying for it, is it wrong?
No, it was about piracy.
Oh, all right. Mm.
But aren't those like some bigger issues?
Terrorism.
Aren't you, you know, don't you have, like, to defend just locking people up without any due process or whatever you do? Get to it.
But yeah, but what about the Black Eyed Peas? What are they going to do? Sure, there's 1,000 people.
B. Diddy in Oklahoma, Mrs. Dash.
Yeah, man, this is Arnold. And it was not Mrs. Dash. It was my weed.
Excellent.
And all the air just got sucked out of the studio.
Taylor in Virginia.
Yeah, man, I'm Mrs. Dash's is a lot of mongrel class of spice.
both spice racks will be destroyed. Thank you.
All right.
Bring it back. Yes,
so they're just going to take words from earlier in the show and combine them into nonsense.
Sure.
And see, there's the O&A references there.
I'm down.
It's a good vibe.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good vibe. We should play some Nazi rap at some point, and we should talk to Rob Paravonian. You got new songs, and you might play one for us.
I just might.
Name a couple of them. We'll pick one.
All right, I got one called "Never Forgets." It's a lovely relationship song.
Uh huh. Does it involve Mrs. Dash and a sphincter?
Not at the moment.
All right,
that'll be the remix.
The true boogie Mrs. Dash remix.
Right. I have another one. It's for the 14-year-olds of America. Make the world a better place. Called "Don't Blow Up Your School."
Oh,
and
timely.
Yes,
very timely.
You know, something for the kids. And then there's, you know, your average standard, you know, love songs, love triangles, pain. I got angry rock song, you know, I got them all.
You got, and then there's always the cocaine song.
Ah, yes, the love triangle, the sad, chemically induced love triangle.
Speaking of love triangles, I got in a whole argument with the gentleman sitting next to you. You met Wayne before, right?
Yeah, yes.
Okay, yeah, that's right, because I won't go into this.
I think they have a feud going, so.
Yeah, we might have a feud going.
Wayne has a feud going with everyone in radio.
They hate everybody
here. Wayne and I got into a long fight on the train on the way in, and I wanted to find out what your opinion of it was. We were talking about men shaving, and Wayne seems to think that genetically and from an evolutionary standpoint that pubic hair is there to protect against infection.
I have really, I don't know.
Really? I thought it was decoration, but you know.
Decoration. Okay.
This is what you guys talk about on the train.
You should see the people.
Is there anyone around you that you're talking about?
We did stop conversations amongst other people.
It's the best way to get a seat, actually.
We're sitting there, and I just turn to him, and I go, when's the last time you shaved?
And I'm like, again, a good buzz. Why are you asking how come and when I shave? What is the fascination with this in you?
Here's the problem.
What?
In about a month.
Yes, you're going to see my junk.
I'm going to see your junk, because we're on the beach, and Wayne pulls his shorts up to look like a diaper.
I like to go for the full body tan.
And he'll have these, like, huge, like, yawny fucking tufts of hair blowing out the sides. And I'm like, dude, can you please buzz that before you go out in public if you're going to pull your drawers up?
Nice.
But I have been buzzing more. Last thing's to worry about, like, my partner and, you know, like, maybe she's getting a mouthful of hair and it's not my problem.
I called Wayne this week to talk about the show,
mm-hmm.
and you called me. He calls me, and I said, "Hey, I just called you a little bit ago." I said, "Thanks for returning my call, Wayne. What are you doing?" He goes, "I'm peeing on the side of a house," and I'm like, "Oh, that's good. No bathrooms in the area," and I'm like, "So this is what happened."
What did I tell you when you asked me if there was any bathrooms?
You needed fresh air?
Occasionally, I like to go outside.
You got to keep the neighbors, make sure they know what your territory is.
Right.
Sure, was it your house?
No, it wasn't mine.
No, he's working. He's doing construction at somebody's house, and then just goes, now, did you actually piss on the house?
Yeah.
What do you leave in the walls?
I do a professional job, that end. But, you know, if you got to go, sometimes you just go outside on a tree or something, you know? whatever it takes, man.
Has anybody ever seen this?
Oh, most definitely. I don't think there's a guy in the profession that has not been caught.
Really?
Red-handed, if you know what I'm saying.
Red-handed.
Or yellow.
Yeah.
You're an animal.
Wow. But do you ever, like, go number two outside?
I have, yes.
What?
Yes, I am.
Romantic Moments with Big Wayne.
Wow.
Yeah.
Amazing how that pops up.
I have a good romantic moment that's actually happened to me in the past week.
No, go back to taking dumps outside. That's just
that only happened
really
one time when I got locked out, you know? If you gotta go, you gotta go.
Wait, is this outside your apartment?
No, outside someone's house I was working at.
And what did you cover it up like a cat?
Not exactly. No, if they're gonna be such fucks to lock me out of their house, I'm shitting on their shrubs. I don't give a shit.
Or you do.
Yeah, actually you do.
Yeah, I do, right. But that's my feeling. If I can work on your $100,000, $200,000, $300,000 house, you know what I'm saying? I should be able to shit in your bathroom.
And there's people that won't let you.
There's certain people that you just get this vibe that it's like you're violating them personally.
Now, any kind of ethnic persuasion, religion?
Occasionally the Jewish persuasion seems to pull the plug, if you know what I'm saying.
Nice.
What do you mean it seems to pull the plug?
They're the ones that seem like to be the most offended by anybody even being in their environment. The Jewish, Rob?
No.
Okay.
Martin Luther King to bring us back to a little understanding. Dude, I got to tell you, back on the toilets in Europe, and I don't know if you experienced this, Reed, you know, you're used to going to the bathroom here, and there's like water at the bottom, so you don't have to get like a good bird's eye view of what you just dropped in there. The toilets are like, first off, some of them are square toilets, and then there's just a like a flat surface in there,
right?
And then there's a little hole at the front, so when you drop a deuce and you turn around, you're looking at it in all its glory. It's not shrouded in water. It's disturbing. Dude, why do they like to look at their shit in Europe?
I think they're trying to save water, but
conservation does not mean that I need to look at my deuce.
I kind of like looking at it. It kind of lets me know whether I'm regular or not.
Well, have you ever been to some places in Asia? It's just literally, it's just a hole.
Yeah.
You got to squat.
I did that in Ireland. Dropped it in a hole. There's just a hole in the...
Where were you?
I don't know. Ungoogle, fucking Schmungfugel. I don't know. It's all the same
place. Did you use the hole?
Sure.
See? You got to go, you go. Whether it's the side of someone's house.
Yeah, except here's the difference. Wayne goes in the bathroom with a coat hanger.
A coat hanger? I don't remember that.
You lifted it up.
Oh, yeah, I've been known, yes, definitely. You know, you get that enormous one. It's kind of like the length of a baby arm. So I tend to call the old lady in, and I get a coat hanger and pull it up just to see if I if it's beat my past records, you know?
Was she keeping a journal?
Well, no, she's not keeping a journal. I'm just so proud of it.
Calls his chick in, like, look what I made.
Yeah, really, and should she go by weight, I think. You know, right.
You want me to pull it out next time and weigh it like a fish?
Because, you know, it can be thinner or thicker, you know, it's, you know.
But yeah, I'm always amazed by my own movements.
That is love.
Yeah. Jeff in Illinois says he uses peen on the front porch to find home. Jeff?
Well, no, that's how I determine where I'm going to live. If I can't piss off my front porch, somebody's living too close to me.
Very good, sir. And where do we live now?
Right.
Which part of Arkansas?
I live in Illinois.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And down about 300 miles south of Chicago, down at the very bottom tip.
You don't want to get too close to Chicago.
Oh, shit. I lived in a town that was 1,200 people for a while, and I couldn't handle that. Too crowded.
1,200 people?
Yeah, I don't want nobody, because if I want to fuck the old lady in the backyard, I'm going to fuck the old lady in the backyard.
So you're telling me like you just wouldn't get into that if you like lived in a big suburbia with 200,000 people?
Oh, shit. I drive a truck for a living. I drive into that shit enough. I sure ain't going to live in it.
So you're not really into unwelcome diversity?
Oh, I don't know. I have friends over and stuff. I just don't want to live close to nobody.
Right. And how many people have you actually killed and put under the porch?
Not under my porch. That's thanks. Don't drag them all over the fucking yard.
Thank you, Jeff. Dude, representing Southern Illinois with some flavor.
Jeez.
Well, that's what happens when I go back to Oklahoma for, like the relatives that I don't see all that often come around. I don't know how you live in New York City. I don't know how you live here, dude. Right. I don't even live in New York City. I live out on the burbs on Long Island. It's like every other town. We got a Best Buy, a Home Depot, and illegal immigrants, you know?
Yeah.
Wayne, you work with some illegal immigrants.
There's some illegals, definitely.
Right, because you're in the construction business.
Mm-hmm.
Are they bugging like they're about to get shipped home?
Not too many, no.
No?
Because I think they found out that there's something that if you actually, like, you know, some of these guys are given 1099 forms at the end of the day. As long as they actually pay some type of tax, they can stay.
No, but did they come across the border illegally?
Oh, sure, most definitely.
I don't think it works that way, Wayne. I think
I'm telling you. If they get a 1099 from their employer and they pay the taxes, there's a loophole. They can stay.
Well, like, the TV news has been babbling like crazy about this whole immigration fight. Do they send them, you know, what do you do with them? And I guess Senator Frist was on that Hannity and Combs. You big fan, Reed?
Fox News.
Yeah, now I got cable. I catch it occasionally.
You said to Sean just a moment ago, they're here illegally. They should go back and get in line to come back in. But wouldn't that create an underground? And you can't just deport 11 million people. That's just not a workable policy, is it?
Yeah, well, I think it is workable.
I mean, you know, we have done the mass transportation of human beings before.
Sure.
I mean, you know, we stopped and traded some cane sugar or whatever the hell.
I thought in Germany they got rid of 11 million real fast. Oh, you're going to hit that button.
Wow.
Well, just so you know, it is Damn. Possible.
Damn!
Thank you. And I don't think it was 11 million. I think it was 6.
There's no actual records.
What are you, a Holocaust denier now?
Mm-hmm.
You don't think it happened?
Well, there seems to be enough of them that got away to let you know that they lived through it.
But the ones who won't let you into their bathroom? As
yeah,
talking about.
Pretty yeah, much. Yeah. There you go.
It's starting to come together now.
Yeah, right. Right. It's amazing that these people don't let you use their bath when you walk in. You're like, hey, you filthy Jew. I guess they missed you.
Yeah. Oh, maybe they heard the show one time, and that's why they don't let you in the bathroom.
Exactly. But back to immigration. Lou Dobbs, who has been, you know,
the crazy old man.
You know, dude, I consider myself like a pretty, whatever, liberal dude. But any other country, if you're there illegally, they put a gun to your head and throw your ass out. I don't get what the debate's about.
Well, not in any other country. They don't do that.
Dude, I've been to those countries.
Why do you think all those Muslims in France are rioting?
Why are they rioting?
I don't know. Just sounded like the thing to say.
He was asking why, actually.
Right. Who cares?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of, you know, in Germany, there's a lot of Turkish immigrants. And
they hate them. Dude, I drank with some Germans. They hate all of them. Well, everybody hates each other.
There's a sense of pride with anybody. We just had St. Patrick's Day. Are you saying that Irish, because they're holding up their Irish flags, that all of a sudden they're not loyal or they're un-American?
You ready to listen to me loud and clear?
I'm here.
I don't think
that we should have any flag flying in this country except the flag of the United States. I don't think there should be a St. Patrick's Day. I don't care who you are.
I'm with it. Damn right. So, red, white, and blue.
So no St. Patrick's Day.
No St. Patty's Day.
What are you? What's your
drinking. I'm English.
I will have to say that St. Patrick's Day and the rest of the country is just kind of like, oh, look, you wore a little green. You know, ooh, big deal. Like, in New York, I've never seen anything like it in my life.
Les, where you grew up, did you even know an Irish person? You know, Irish rednecks.
Rob?
I'm sure
are you Irish?
No.
Okay. But I don't want to offend our guests.
No,
yeah.
In Chicago, St. Patrick's Day is ridiculous huge. They dye the river green, or more green than it usually is.
No, that's right.
Hey, look
that's
at
right.
us. We're going to fuck the fish. Yeah, great. Good job. Dumbass, why don't you guys go mortar each other some more over Protestant... when I was in Ireland, I made like a quick joke about the whole thing. They're not down with that. You get kidnapped in the middle of the night by Sinn Féin or whoever those fools are.
You made a joke about St. Patrick's Day?
No, I made a joke about how the... I was like, what's the deal with the Protestants and Catholics? You're on the same team, stupid.
No.
What are you doing? They're acting real. Like a bunch of red-haired rappers, you dumbasses. Cool out.
That's crazy.
Well, Jon Stewart was playing the clips from Lou Dobbs and actually got Lou Dobbs on the phone because, you know, if we get rid of parades, there's some issues.
Well, I said in response to a guest that I'm not a big fan of celebrating our differences. I'm more of a fan of celebrating our similarities. It wouldn't bother me a bit if Columbus Day, St. Patrick's Day, those sort of ethnocentric holidays went away and we celebrated our commonalities and similarities as Americans.
Lou, I got to interrupt you. Do you understand that New York is a parade-based economy?
That is true, too.
Dude, it is nuts.
It is true.
That Puerto Rican Day parade, they probably spend about $1.25 that day. I will have to say that the St. Patrick's Day, I was up at some of the famous Irish bars. Where are those? Read like on the Upper East Side or somewhere
in New York City.
Yeah,
there's. I mean, there are Irish bars everywhere.
There's this one strip, and I could never seen it in my life. Cops and firemen in uniform, just like pounding beers while this midget is like doing cartwheels down the bar. It was the craziest goddamn thing I've ever seen.
Was the midget Irish?
Well, of course, he had the little funny thing like, I got my pot of gold, you know, whatever, you little mutant. We should play Jaguar Skills and then take a quick break and then come back. We'll get during break, we'll get Rob set up with his guitar. How many strings you got on that thing?
5.5.
All right. Now, E-Rock, are we going to be able to put like a mic on his, on his mouth? What are you watching? Hitler videos over here? What is this? It's a guy getting his eye taken out.
Ew.
No response?
I didn't know that's what it was.
Oh. Jesus, he's watching like Nazi training Auschwitz videos over here. Are we going to be able
with
to...
the theme.
Yeah, we'll have them all set up.
All right. So, Reed, explain Jaguar Skills. He's a real human being that we talk to, and these things are sort of loosely or very much so based on his real life.
Well, sort of, yeah. I mean, he's left over from the old show, but he's a real guy. He's a DJ who lives in a secret mountain hideaway in Spain, right?
And he emailed me, this dude emailed me out of the blue and said, hi, I'm a ninja. I live in a hideout, and I mean, I get a lot of fucked up email, but I'm like, yo, so we start corresponding, you talk to him on the phone, he's a DJ, that he was just spinning in Moscow, we interviewed him on our show, and he was spinning in Ibiza, or as they say in Europe, Ibiza, and was like... There, Kate Moss was trying to bang him. He has this crazy lifestyle.
That's right, Jay Jagger. He's seen her down there.
And
remember that?
Yeah, exactly. And but you talk to him on the phone, and he's like, "Oh man, I'm burnt on hash." And you know, I was teaching a martial arts course this morning, and he's a weird dude. So we created a cartoon, an audio cartoon about his life.
Right. We decided to turn him into basically a superhero by exaggerating his lifestyle, and it's like a throwback to the 1920s or 1930s when they used to do these radio serials. You know, once a week they would have a little installment and an adventure of a radio hero, and so we've done it with DJ Jaguar Skills, and we used to play these on the old show, and this is a new installment, which is what, six, Lazlo? Number six?
Number five.
Number five.
It is number five. So this is, without further ado, this is the most recent, the newest episode of Jaguar Skills. We'll play this, and then we'll go to break and come back with Rob Paravonian.
My name is DJ Jaguar Skills. Secret ninja powers are revealed to me when I hold aloft my magic stick.
Jaguar Skills.
With my fly Ebony Honey at my side. And my friends, the mighty Fat Boss crew at my back, I battle evil.
Jaguar Skills, the funkiest ninja in the universe.
Jaguar Skills. We join our hero as he returns to his hideout after a long night of DJing.
Yo.
To find the locks on his secret ninja hideout have been changed.
Oh, Jesus, what's this? Evicted!
This damn sure better be good. I'm getting a manicure with the jewels embedded and a mural to Biggie and Tupac on each nail.
Listen, bitch, I've been evicted from my hideout.
Ninja, please. I don't care about what happens with that tree fort of yours.
You mean the top secret ninja base hidden in the mountain, don't you?
Whatever, fool. I'm gonna get this woman right here to pretty up my lady kitten next. I'm out.
Bollocks.
Will our hero be out on the streets? Will he have to DJ birthday parties to make money?
What are you?
I'm the birthday boy. I want to hear some Wiggles. Now.
Fucking poof. Wiggle to this.
Got the police coming straight from the underground.
Smoky music.
Or will he work as an actor in the adult film Brokeback Ninja?
I wish I knew how to quit you.
Hold me, ninja.
Hey, look, man, I was just kidding, you faggot.
And will the people at social services figure out he's spending 100% of his welfare money on sweet Jamaican skunk?
Yo.
Tune in next time for the adventures of...
Jaguar Skills! Jaguar Skills! Five gorgeous young ninja pimps protecting Earth's entire galaxy. Always five, acting as one. Dedicated, inseparable, invincible.
I'm checking out the manga porn.
I love it.
It's just disturbing.
I do. Like the things that they're doing to those Asian girls is disturbing.
And why? In every panel, it's raining. Have you noticed this? Even when they're indoors,
right?
And I don't want to know what it's raining.
Yeah. It's like a Hemingway book or something, except with Asian girls with breasts larger than any Asian girl should ever have.
I'm falling into the cultural divide.
Well, dude, you used to have yellow fever, and then you actually went to Asia, and then it was over with.
Well.
Because I remember you came back. Where did you go?
Hong Kong.
Yeah, you came back, and you're like, dude,
no,
all the beautiful ones came here.
It's true, man. It's true.
We've got Kung Fui from Whackbag calling in, saying he's starting a civil war.
I am not starting a civil war. The Mexicans are, damn it. I heard the audio last night. They're doing a rally in Sacramento, and this Monday they're going to do what rallies in 60 cities. They're actually calling out to rise up against the white man and take their land back and start a civil war.
We got their land fair and square in the... What? Come on, somebody history.
Mexican War.
Thank you. Yep. Mexican War.
Yeah, we did.
1848.
They deserve all the Social Security benefits for working illegally for all these years, and they want to shoot us, take a land back.
Now, where did you see this?
I heard it. A political talk show, an AM station in Sacramento, a guy named Mark Williams. Good guy.
Let me tell you a little something about AM radio.
I know about AM radio. I'm saying he's a good guy. He's not...
He's not like those other psychopaths here in the trailer park.
Does he have an OxyContin habit?
Right.
No.
Now, are you really afraid the Mexicans are going to rise up against you?
No, I got heat.
Listen, dude, your name is Kung Fui. Can't you pull on some Master Po on him?
Fuck no.
Well, listen, dude, good luck on barricading yourself in.
Help me.
I'll bring you a Cholito. Rob Paravonian is going to play a quick song for us. Now, can you come figure out, like, hit the buttons there and make sure that we can hear what he's doing?
Oh, that's lovely.
Oh, baby. Right. Oh, so we took Wayne's mic away.
Oh, well, there's could use that one over there. All right, this is a song about a love triangle, which is the saddest of all love shapes. As we know, love squares are fun, love octagons, oh my god. But love triangles, here we go. I love her, but she's in love with another man. I've seen him, and I must say that I don't understand why she would pick a man like him instead of me. And I think there's only one thing it could be. He's got coke, so he gets the girl. There's nothing I can do or say. I can offer her a heart that's warm, but my love won't take powdered form, so she won't give me the time of day. It's been hard to see my girl with such a thug when I can't even get a friendly hug. I'll never win. I guess I must make that admission. All the charm in the world is no match for a chemical addiction. He's got coke, so he gets the girl. And that's the way it's gonna be. That's the way it's gonna be. She doesn't care who I am, cause she measures love by the gram. And that's why she'll never fall for me. Here's the bridge. I thought I needed charm and good looks and strength of character. All those women's magazines told me so. But none of that crap got me any closer to winning her. Cause all I really needed was some blow. You know that's all I need. Cause she's a horrible judge to this character she always blocks. I'll never get her to break free from her Skinner box. He's got the key to the pleasure centers in her brain. That's why he has got my lover so well trained. Last chorus. He's got coke, so he gets the girl. But I still think that I can win in time. I still think I win. Cause if I ever get the cash, I'm gonna buy myself a major stash. And then her love will be inspired, and she'll never get tired. As long as I keep her wired, she'll be mine.
Nice. Ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, thank you very much, XM Nation.
Right. So, Cocor potential you've had in the past.
Actually, I was recently in Chicago, and I did. I was playing at the comedy club there. Unbeknownst to me, the woman who inspired the song was in the audience.
So it is true. I knew it was true.
It's
happened to me.
9/11, they blew up the...
Oh, sorry.
It's based on a true story.
I'm sure.
Based on actual events.
Nice.
And what did she stand up and be like, "You a bitch!"
No. You owe her royalties now?
I think so. Yeah. No, actually, I didn't know she was there till after the show, which is great.
Yeah.
And, turns out she's married to the guy now, so apparently...
Really?
He's either a really good dealer or they both cleaned up.
Wow. I was with a coke whore once. It was a bad scene.
And it was a coke whore once.
Clearly. Yeah, I was reading this week, Lazlow. Did you read this thing about...
Well, we got to go to the phones.
Okay.
That was a good segue, though, Reed. You're doing good.
But it was right along the line.
Dude, you're going to have to bring it up later because Jim Florentine's on the phone.
Oh.
And he's about to go into his second set because he's doing comedy down in Virginia.
Hook it up.
Florentine.
No, I'm in North Carolina.
Whatever. Listen, slave state equals slave state.
Well, yeah, absolutely. But let me, the cocor is the key with that. Is I've never done coke in my life, but the key is you just got to friggin' wait it out. You know what I mean? You're not going to get any pussy till like 8 in the morning.
Why?
Because, you know, that's when I feel like coming down and horny, that's when you get it. You really got to just put your time in and chill. I'll be sneaking Red Bulls. I'm fucking popping pills, whatever, you know what I mean, to keep me up.
So
and then you gotta listen to these whores babble for fucking hours before you get pussy.
So you have some experience, like you and Paravonian here evidently have been with a couple of coke whores.
Oh yeah, I mean, this girl I used to date was, you know, she used to bring chicks home and stuff like that, and they were both, you know, they're doing coke all the time, and I'd have to wait till like 8, 9 in the morning. I'd tell my friends, like, I don't want to do this shit anymore. Like, are you, what are you, out of your mind? I'm like, you gotta deal with this. I would get home at 2 and I don't get a pussy for 7 hours. I'd rather just joke her off at 2:30 in the morning, go to sleep.
That's excellent. Florentine invited Wayne and I to come backstage at Caroline's a couple weeks ago, and you killed, dude. It was a good vibe, but you know, Jimmy Norton did a nice set before you, but I thought he was going to kill somebody. What happened? He stopped it like at the beginning of a set and looked like, and the when Jim Norton gets that rage. You can see it from far away. I thought he was going to murder somebody.
Yeah, I don't know what happened with that. I forgot to ask him after the show.
There was like some French dude, I think, who in like was babbling about his tab while...
Oh, yeah. He didn't like Jim's... he wasn't laughing at Jim's stuff, and Jim was watching him before he went on a stage, and then when he got on stage, the guy was just complaining about his check, and Jim just got really aggravated because he hates the French. And he hates everybody, but he definitely hates the French, I know that.
Well, like the guy didn't think that the humor was going to be so blue at your show. I think was what he was upset about. I think he was a Christian frog.
Well, that's what happens at Caroline's. You know, it's right on Broadway in Manhattan. You get people coming off the street like, oh, comedy club. Yeah, we just saw the play and we'll go to the comedy. And then they walk in there like, oh, my God, what is this? You know what I mean? They're from, like, you know, the fat soccer moms from the Midwest are horrified. It's beautiful.
There was a few women in the back row of because I was sitting sort of on the back, on the side. And I was able to see the reactions of people. They were when Jim went up there and started going on about 5 minutes about his asshole. There was people bugging.
Yeah, and then that Laura Levitis chick was on the show.
Oh yeah, she was good.
And she's really dirty too. It was great. She's talking about, like, you know, how she likes it in the ass and she'll just shit it out. Yeah. You know what I mean? She doesn't want to get pregnant. They were disgusted. It was beautiful.
How's comedy going down in the South there?
That's all right. They're a little conservative. It's Raleigh, North Carolina. You know, they have that big lacrosse thing, you know, rape thing down here at Duke. So I've been talking about that, making the audience very uncomfortable.
That's got to be great.
That's nice. Oh, dude, what do you expect from a sport where, you know, guys run around on grass with their bag on a stick?
Yeah, I mean, come on. They're fags. You know what I mean? It's a step above soccer if you're a guy playing lacrosse.
Now, there's a lot of guys that think soccer's a very masculine sport.
Who?
They're evidently all non-American, because everywhere I go in the world, they're like, soccer, and here, soccer is not for most people. But the World Cup's coming. Are you going to be watching?
Yeah, I live right by the Meadowlands. I wouldn't step foot there when it's there.
Well, see, the problem, we need a good soccer riot, or at least a good NFL riot. That would get me involved in sports. I can't even deal with professional sports. It's a bunch of, like, overpaid sissies either running in a circle, i.e. baseball, and grabbing their nuts, or, you know, a bunch of guys trying to steal each other's land, i.e. football. Hang down.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, you know, look, lacrosse is gay. That's the bottom line.
One really thing to take away from,
like,
this.
You know, if there was a Chippendale dancer at the friggin' party, I could see them raping him. And he didn't rape female dancers. You know how politically correct this friggin' country is? It's ridiculous. The coach of the lacrosse team resigned. He wasn't even there. The kids just, you know, afterwards rented out a house and had a party and brought some strippers there. What did he have to do with it?
Well, because that's the thing. If somebody does something bad, then everybody else has to resign. It's retarded.
It wasn't like he was there, you know, and egging him on, you know. Maybe one of the kids is raping the stripper and going, you're not going fast enough, and the coach is pushing his ass cheek.
So,
I've done that before in trains. My friend's not going fast enough, so I push his cheeks. Come on, move it.
Probably,
I got another load brewing.
Probably the part where people were most horrified at your Caroline show was where you were yelling at Norton as he was sort of backstage. About how you used to leave each other logs. And Wayne was just... Wayne not only leaves logs for his girl, he pulls them out with a coat hanger to show what he made.
So you can see the full length, Jim.
Really?
Sure.
Hold it up like you caught a fish?
Exactly. And I'm proud of it.
That's beautiful, because chicks hate logs.
You can see them all on Flickr.
There's nothing better than leaving a turd in the bowl for a broad, you know, and she finds it in the morning or whatever. Whenever she finds it, it's great, especially if it's sticking out of the water, you get a really good one.
I love it.
I was trying to explain to people, if you're going to leave a turd for your chick, make sure you stick the toilet paper on the side of the bowl. It sticks to the side
exactly,
like glue.
Exactly, I love it.
you don't want to throw it on top of it. It ruins the joke.
It also kills the smell.
Yeah, absolutely. It kills the smell, too.
So it's basically, there's two components of it. It would be the smell, the olfactory experience, and then the sight.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, the sight, you know, absolutely. I mean, yeah, me and Jim used to do that. We used to leave shirts for each other all the time.
How did you guys ever get laid?
Oh, we'd flush them before the chicks came home.
Yeah, but that didn't always happen, from what I understand.
Well, yeah, well, that was the story I was telling on stage, a true story. Like, I left a turd for Jim, and then he was bringing some girl back to our house, and she liked me, and I said, Jim, you try to bang her, don't worry about it. I'll hang in the city, you bring her back to the place, and just call me, and I'll come home, you know? I'm a trooper like that. But she had a crush on me. I go, Jim, you can bang her, just get her loaded. I did it. So he, you know, he takes her out, he gets her loaded and all that stuff, he brings her back to our house, and she's like, well, Jim Florentine's going to be there. He goes, no, don't worry, he's out of town, he's been on the road for 2 weeks. And then they get there, and she goes, I got to use the bathroom. I left him a turd earlier, but I forgot about it. I didn't do it on purpose. She went in the bathroom, comes out, you fucking pig, you left shit in the bowl. He's like, what are you talking about? And then he went in there and saw it. He couldn't even blame it on me, because he just lied and said I was on the road for 2 weeks. She's like, take me back to the city, you fucking asshole. And I cock-blocked him because of my turd.
That's brilliant.
Yeah, I felt really bad. It's the only time I ever cock-blocked the guy, but it was a good laugh afterwards.
Now, why did you...
He didn't care, because as soon as he dropped her off, he got a hooker.
Yeah, I'll show her. Florentine's got some dates coming up. You're going to be doing... where are you? Charlie Goodnight's right now?
Yeah.
And then you're going to the Comedy Cabaret Friday and Saturday, April 14th and 15th. That's in Doylestown, Pennsylvania. April 27th and 30th, you're at Go Bananas in Cincinnati, Ohio. Where do they come up with all these names for comedy clubs, dude?
I don't know. They're awful. I know. You know.
What's the lamest one? Ha-ha?
Oh.
Is there a ha?
I don't think that there's a ha comedy club in New York that I won't do just because of the name.
Yeah, it's just one ha.
Right.
It used to be a Tickles.
A Tickles?
Yeah, Tickles Comedy Club.
Well, and then you're at the Funny Farm in Roswell, Georgia?
Yeah, that's another awful name.
May 11th to the 13th.
How about just call it a comedy club?
Yeah, just call it the Comedy Club instead of the Funny Farm.
They have a chain up in Canada called Yuck Yucks. That's another awful one.
Oh, yeah. Let's go to Yuck Yucks and see that Jim Florentine. He goes, yay. Hey. Anybody?
Dwayne's in the studio?
I'm here, Jim.
Wayne, yeah, fuck Lazlow.
Me and Lazlow were talking a couple weeks ago how you and Club Soda Kenny are two of comedy's best-kept secrets.
Yeah, he was trying to fill me in.
It's amazing. I'm telling you guys doing, like, and I hate cop buddy movies because they're awful and they're so cliche, but just imagine Kenny, Club Soda Kenny, and Wayne. Wayne smoking crack and with that friggin' deadpan dumb look, driving around trying to friggin' do whatever, capture guy. It would be hilarious.
Maybe they, like, both live on a boat, like in Riptide.
You know, like they have the Montreal Comedy Festival every year trying to find new talent and stuff like that. Wayne and Kenny, just put them together.
What are they going to do, fight crime?
I don't know. I haven't thought about it. But just let them, you know what, just let them improv for an hour and a half. It'll be hilarious.
It might work.
Well,
you don't even need a script with those two.
Correct. Well,
you just let Wayne look. Wayne tells his stories, and Kenny friggin' just nods. Fucking the movie.
That's an interesting story about how you fucked a homeless girl.
Yeah, I like that. I hear you.
I'm over here now. You dropped something.
But Wayne, you will get famous one day.
I hope so.
Florentine, it's up to you. Listen, I got no juice, dude. I work on video games. Reed's unemployed. Rob Paravonian's a traveling minstrel singer. And Wayne's a carpenter. You're on Comedy Central. People know you. You got to make this happen.
I made a career to making fun of retards. I don't know how much juice I got either.
Hey, there's only one person among us that has a DVD out, and that would be you.
Well, yeah, you know, because nobody else wanted to put it out. I had to put it out myself.
Burns them at home.
When you chase chicks, for, you know, at an abortion clinic or a coat hanger, you know, the industry's not really on to that.
Really?
So, yeah, they frown on that stuff for some reason.
So really?
I can't understand why.
So Miramax sort of didn't want to have a power lunch with you about it.
Yeah, they did. They get a little afraid. We were actually, our first DVD, we take Upper Deckers, we take a shit in the top of the tank. You know what I mean? And put the lid back on, and then when you flush the bowl, the shit goes into the bowl.
It's great, Jim. I do this in
years.
Real life, so it doesn't really faze me.
What do you mean you do this?
I know.
That's been done in customers' homes.
for Wayne, that's like, you know, he probably did that. That was probably the first place he took a shit was in at the top of the tank.
Wait, let me get this straight. When you're working on somebody's house...
They piss you off. Like, I'm pissing on the side of their house. Someone's shitting in their tank.
They got to know that one of the construction guys did it.
It's brown water. I don't know what happened. You got a bad system. Your septic tank's backing up.
For like 2 weeks.
Right.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it could have been the next guy that came in and did work.
Exactly. Jim knows he's had his house violated.
So they just keep buying some of those stupid blue things and putting them in there? Never gets any better?
Yeah, eventually, after like 9 flushes, the thirds come out. Yeah, about 9 flushes.
Oh, right. Unless they keep their whiskey in there like JJ from that episode of Good Time. You with me?
Yeah. I only seen it recently.
What are you doing watching Good Time?
I got cable now. I'm on Nick at Night. I'm on TV Land. This is all the shit I've been missing for like fucking 10 years.
I don't think you missed. I don't think you missed Good Time.
Yeah, it's a hot new show.
Like the reruns is what I mean.
Are they in reruns? I thought that was really. There's a great new show on called What's Happening. You seen that one?
No, I haven't seen that one.
You have seen What's Happening Now.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's the remake. Jim Florentine, the website's jimflorentine.com, and you've got that Meet the Creeps 2 that's got... how long is that thing?
An hour and a half.
That's excellent. It's a value for money. What's the price? $19.99?
Yeah, 15 at shows.
Have you done a search on the internet and see if people have pirated it yet?
No, I don't care. I have no problem with anyone stealing it. I really don't. I don't care. It gets my name out there. You know, it's just like, wow, look at this. Pass it around. Check this clip out. You know what I mean? That's the way I look at it. Like, if I steal a song from, like, you know, from the internet and I like it, I'll go out and buy the CD.
Right.
Or, you know, I'll listen to the whole CD. There's only one good song. I wouldn't buy it anyway, so I'll be happy I stole the one song. That's the way I look at it.
And you're also on Comedy Central, right?
We do it on that broadband channel. On their, they got a broadband channel on the internet called Motherload. We do a Meet the Creeps. We do a hidden camera series on there. Same stuff, but a little tamer.
Of course. A lot
no upper deckers, no abortion clinics, you know.
Excellent. And you're about to go on to your second set there, Charlie Goodnight's?
Yeah, I got to do another set here, so.
Excellent. So you're doing tomorrow night as well?
Yeah, tomorrow night, and then we have Philly. Doylestown's right outside of Philly, like 30 minutes out of Philly, so.
Cool. And
be a good show next weekend.
Excellent. Well, the website again, jimflorentine.com. Thanks for calling in, buddy.
Thanks, man. I hope you guys get a show, man. It'll be great.
Dude, good well, whatever show. Happens when you get Wayne, his show, I get 10%.
Jim, take it easy, buddy.
All right, man.
Thanks, buddy. I'm serious about the 10%.
You get 10%? No problem. I'll give you 25.
Name myself Lazlow.
Just make something happen.
We got to put you together with Club Soda Kenny, dude.
I'm willing to give it a shot.
You think so?
Sure.
Well,
if he's just got to laugh at my dumb jokes, he's got a pretty easy gig.
Jesus Christ. On our last show on K-Rock, you know our show's done at K-Rock, Rob. Did you get that?
I heard a rumor to that.
Yeah, we pulled the plug.
You just didn't, like, tune in on a Sunday night and like, where are those guys?
Did you actually ever listen to the show after?
I did, yeah.
You got off pretty light, by the way, because there was a couple of people in there that Wayne laid into, and it was
really?
It was over, Johnny.
Well, I appreciate that.
Yeah, good. Be glad you're not a black albino, because Wayne's very first show. If you go to the website, every show that we did on K-Rock is posted there on MP3.
Except that one?
No, it's posted.
Oh. It was posted.
That the very Wayne walked in the door, literally threw a bunch of weed down, started to roll a Dutch, had about 8 Red Bulls that he stole out of Howard Stern's freaking green room, and then started laying into this black albino that he wasn't really black.
He's white. If he's a black albino, he's a white guy.
Oh, he was a white... Yeah, I don't know why. It was some kind of like weird parallel universe.
He had the cross-eyed syndrome.
Oh, he was cross-eyed.
Multiple things wrong with
him. Right.
Cleft foot.
Right. And it proved to us that Reed is such a brilliant producer. He's... booking like Down syndrome patients on the show.
Oh, come on now.
That what? Guy's funny though.
He's
you know
hilarious.
Him, don't
he's
you?
Actually, yeah.
Oh, do you know
Thank
him?
You very much.
Yeah. Oh, you're
I've seen him. He's really funny.
Oopsie, so you're good friends, are you?
Yeah, actually pretty good.
Good.
Well, excellent. if it's the black albino with the lazy eye that
no.
I'm thinking of.
No.
The one in
Illinois?
Oh, no, I'm thinking of the guy from Minneapolis.
Nope.
Oh,
must
okay.
be a different one.
But the one from Minneapolis is ridiculously funny. He's actually directing his first movie next month.
I read that and I almost finished. I almost brought it in for you guys. And look where we are. Well, the guy you
but
made
did,
fun
I
of
mean,
has
did
got
he
his
fire
own
back? Because he's actually a good improviser. So did he fire back at
no,
all?
He did
or
it
no?
weirdly.
He
was actually, I thought he was pretty good. He handled me pretty
when,
well.
He's one of those guys that when he has a heckler at a show, he can just destroy him. So that's why when you're talking about him, it's like, Victor's really... Oh, should I have said...
you know? You could say,
well, whatever. But yeah, he's... So I'm surprised he didn't, you know, like, if he was... If, I yeah. mean, if he didn't fire back, that you know, surprised me. He's really good.
He was oddly caught off guard, you know, and
really?
I've seen him live, and I think he's really, really funny, and I've seen him on TV, and I think he's great, but it's weird, because when we got to the show, he just kind of clammed up.
Troy in Wyoming.
Ramon, get rid of this young boy's body and give Lazlow the golden ticket.
That wasn't a very good Ramon impression, I gotta say.
No.
It was all right. Do you even know who Ramon is, Wayne?
I'm a little familiar, yes.
No, you are. So that night that we did the last show on K-Rock, one of these goons that was trying to sabotage our show took the real doll that Howard had slept with on multiple occasions.
Violated.
Violated. It was chopped into pieces, like the arms and legs. You know what the real doll is?
I've
it's
heard of
it's
it.
It's like a $6,000 doll or whatever. Well,
they actually have an anime one, an anime model.
Do they?
Someone forwarded me a picture of it.
An anime real doll.
Yeah, so if you're like that kind of the anime porn.
Well,
or
not
manga,
only have
whatever.
They done that, they've now made a male version.
I've had easily thousands of letters, phone calls, emails, you name it. People saying, well, where's the male doll? You guys have 5 different female bodies and no males. Where is
he? Reedy, did you call these guys?
Oh, because I'm gay, right?
No males.
I get it.
That's where
he's
going
for. This is the very first male doll right here. What we've done with this prototype is come up with a way of kind of an exchangeable system so that you could have different sizes and different states of arousal.
So you just basically pop the junk off, and there's like there's several different ones. Like there's some that are soft, some that are hard.
Why would you want the soft?
I love it.
Why do you want? Is it just sitting around waiting for company? Why?
I don't know.
Yeah.
Classic.
She wants to work them up. Yes. She wants to get them excited
to talk about your problems.
Sure.
Right.
It's someone
role playing.
Yeah, someone who listens finally.
Right. Because there's nothing that you know, nothing more sexy and realistic than talking to. A big pile of rubber, and then going, yeah, am I turning you on? And then pulling his cock completely off, right. Setting it aside, and attaching a new one. It even makes a noise.
Excellent.
Ouch.
Of arousal.
See? There's the click.
He would smile once he got that attached. One doll takes us about 80 man hours, and the male doll costs
$6,999. $6,900. I love how they always do that in price. And it's not $7,000. No, no.
Yeah, the dirtiest thing he said was man hours.
Right, exactly.
I don't know what it means, but it scares me.
The male doll costs $6,999. With this male doll, you know, we're very curious to see what do our possible female customers want.
You always need to do focus groups, right? If you've got a new product, you know, if you've got like cranberry flavored Sprite or whatever, you got to test this stuff out. So on this show where they were doing this mini documentary thing on the male real doll, they bring chicks in to monkey around with the thing and see how they'll react to it.
Female customers want out of this male doll. What do they want to see? What kind of functions does he need to have? What, you know, what's important to them?
Probably the junk. I gotta say. Probably the junk.
What's important to them?
Oh, he's got perfect hair. Oh,
this is the perfect man and the perfect toy. Finally, women have the perfect plaything. Well, he won't cheat on you. He's always hard. He doesn't steal the remote, and he doesn't steal the covers.
Shallow bitch.
I'm tired.
Fulfills her fantasy of wanting to be able to take it off.
I don't understand what kind of chick would actually...
Yeah, I don't get it either, because chicks really do determine whether or not, you know...
Right, and how hard is it if you're a girl to get a real dude? Why you got to spend $6,000,
man? I think there's a little bit of false advertising. I think that's for guys. That's what I think it's for. I think it's for another guy.
You might be onto something there.
Sure.
That's true.
If they want to send us one, I'm willing to try it.
Because it's still covers. You'll never complain you've gained too much weight.
You'll never complain that you gained too much weight.
Come on.
How much do they weigh anyway? Are they like normal? Or are they really heavy?
He'll get to that.
Oh, okay.
What are you doing, E-Rock?
tidying up.
Fucking up my flow.
If only it were this easy for your man at home. Never change his cock.
So now that'll stay hard as long as you want it.
So wild.
One of the largest appeals of our dolls is that they satisfy this fantasy, this completely idealized physical form.
Having sex with a real guy. Do you know what I mean? You can use his fingers, you can use his cock.
It's like having sex with a real guy.
Who's dead.
I'm telling you, they were showing these chicks, it was like Weekend at Bernie's in this way. It was like they're dragging this stupid-ass guy. It's like a Ken doll.
You can use his cock, and he's soft.
Oh, yeah.
That was shocking.
It wasn't too hard to get on top of him.
In spite of the extensive weight reduction that we've used in the male doll to get the weight down, it still is not light, especially for a woman.
I can't wait. You always hear the stories about, like, a chick with a fat dude on top. And
dying.
Like, yeah, he dies. She can't wait till they find some hoe underneath a real doll.
Light, especially for a woman. Generally, our customers use some sort of office chair with wheels to do most of the transporting, and then they just have to lift it from the chair to the bed.
Oh my God! It's like just all dead weight.
Here, move him up on the bed. Grab his shoulder.
Okay.
That is not sexy at all. That's like rubbing somebody off of the mob. When you're done, you roll them up in a carpet and you like throw them outside. What?
Right, but beforehand, see if he'll pop you in the poop.
Hey, that looks like the guy we seen. What was his name again? Dino Bravo.
Oh, when we went to the porn shoot. That does look like Dino Bravo.
Does it look like Dino?
And since I was like...
2 inches away.
2 inches away from his cock.
Yeah.
We went to this porn shoot, Rob, and I've got the microphone. I'm talking to the guy. You know, he's a porn star.
Impressive.
And he just starts undressing right in front of me.
And Lass never stops the interview. Just keeps the interview going. The guy's cock is rubbing on his belt buckle.
No, it did not.
It was. Reed, did it make contact?
No, it did not make contact.
I don't know, but it was wagging right there, dude. He was like inches away.
And Wayne's over there. I just hear Wayne giggling. Dude, I didn't want to like mess up
the
on
guy's
this.
Rhythm.
Dude. That guy, say what you will about him, but how he went as long as he did without blowing a load, he was nailing. We were in these director's chairs. I got to tell you, I'm still like messed up from this. We were in director's chairs at a porn shoot trying to keep a straight face while like this guy's nailing chicks in the pooper.
For 2 hours.
For 2 hours.
Good times.
Yeah, man.
Here, move him up on the bed. Grab his shoulders.
Okay.
1, 2, 3.
I think if they could put something in his ball sack to squeeze it to make it ejaculate, because if you're holding on to the cock...
I love it.
Good customer feedback.
Yeah, great.
Good customer feedback.
Maybe he can get you
pregnant.
What's
he going to shoot out, though? What liquid is he going to shoot out?
Silly string.
Egg beaters.
Ball sack to squeeze it to make it ejaculate, because if you're holding on to the cock, you can squeeze the balls, because most women actually like to play with them. Well, I know I do. I like to play with the balls while I fuck myself.
I'd like to add in...
Nah, I gotta say, man, I like my balls tickled, but don't be fucking squeezing them and like playing ping pong with them, man. That shit's out. It's a sensitive zone.
So, I'd like to add in a nicer asshole so that I could, you know, get a strap on and fuck him in the ass. Because I think a lot of girls really fantasize about that.
Yeah, I'm sure they do.
Right.
Yeah, a lot of girls fantasize about banging... either a dead person or a doll in the ass. Sure, huh? Where did they pick these hoes up? I will have to say, watching, a couple of them had fake breasts.
Hmm.
I think they went to some strippers and went like, hey, honey.
Yeah,
you
know, I know.
I'll give you a couple of lines of blow if you come bang this doll for a while.
And fuck him in the ass. Because I think a lot of girls really fantasize about that.
I just don't see a chick getting that excited, like, straddling a doll.
Straddling latex. Yeah, they're pros, man. Clearly.
What was that crazy thing you had in that Japanese porn
magazine?
Oh,
man, where is that thing?
Oh, here it is, yes.
It was like...
Oh, dude, I don't even know what this thing is. It looks like It's sort of like a milkshake maker, except they put a hand on the end of it.
I'd be willing to try that, too.
Right.
It looks like it's Sonic.
Right. Excellent.
I don't know. It's all in Japanese, but
it's a little hand thing
that'll whack you off.
It's a mechanical hand.
Your own hand is too tired,
right.
Try the Feng Shui Gingong machine.
Our men and our sex.
Yeah. Y'all worked well for us.
Oh, come on.
Seriously.
Turning into like a Kathy comic strip from the 80s. Oh, men.
Kathy?
Remember Kathy? She was that woman with the glasses and she was all dowdy and she could never get a dude and she was always complaining about men.
You are a nasty sissy!
Who the fuck reads Kathy?
You don't know Kathy?
I know Kathy.
I know who she is.
Thank you. You're just pop culture illiterate, Leslie.
No, I'm not pop culture illiterate.
You don't leave your house.
I just don't read stupid shit.
That was like 20 years ago. I think it might still be written.
Oh, really? It's just something so lame, you know, you read it. You did read it, or at least you know about it.
Dude, there's a guy from LeClaire, Texas, that has been on hold for 2 hours and 28 minutes.
Let's throw him a bone. Let's say hello.
LeClaire, is that your name?
Yeah.
Oh, you're a girl.
Hello.
You French?
Okay, now you've been on hold for like...
forever.
Okay,
but I've been listening to your show. It's been great.
Thank you. And it seems that you're a little mixed up because you've got an English accent, but you're in Texas.
No, I'm Australian.
Oh.
I'm in Texas.
Whatever. You used to be English and then they moved.
Oh, hell, don't give me that shit.
Well, you're a prison colony. What do you want?
I know we are. That means we're nice and wicked.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay, now why have you been on hold for 2.5 hours?
Well, because a friend of mine hooked me on to the show. And
it's been on for one night.
I know, but he's obviously heard you before.
Oh,
so anyway.
He downloads the show that we used to do on K-Rock.
Yeah.
All right.
So anyway, and then I was listening, and I heard you talking about sex and blow, and I heard you talk about gay people, and I heard you talk about porn, which is one of my favorite subjects. So then I just had to listen, and I had to ring you up.
All right, and what do you got?
What have I got?
For us.
What have I got for you?
Yes.
What would you like me to have for you?
I don't know, darling. You've been on hold for 2.5 hours.
Wayne wants photos. Huh? You want photos?
Wayne does.
Oh, does he? What sort of photos would he like?
Come on. I want you in your wedding dress.
I don't have a wedding dress.
I want you naked.
Oh, I have photos of that.
Oh, all right. Well, what am I through?
There's the website is lazlow.com and everything will be forwarded to Big Wayne.
Uh-huh.
So if you go there, there's an email. You can email us.
Hold on, I'm going to save us some trouble. How old are you?
How old am I?
Yes.
I'm in my 30s.
All right. What do you look like?
What do I look like? I'm 5 foot tall. I'm a redhead. I've got green eyes.
Send the pictures. I don't want no fat pig sending you pictures.
Joe in Jersey. Thank you. Joe in Jersey, when he was going to talk to us, he evidently had slept with a dead person.
Whoa.
Yeah. It's a good vibe. Reed sent me something. You know, Reed does tons of research for the show. And when I say tons of research, I mean playing video games and his boxers and eating Rice Krispies. He sent me probably the worst piece of 80s rehashed culture. What was the name of the guy that was the bully on Back to the Future?
Biff.
Right, right. And the actor's name is Tom Wilson.
Mm-hmm.
And he's got a website.
Yeah, I don't know. Apparently, the guy's career is dried up now, so now he's making music.
Sweet.
That's just so weird.
We kind of have a musician in the room who may or may not be doing okay, so...
Well, he was never in a movie.
Were you in Back to the Future?
Not that I'm aware of, no.
Okay. How's your career?
Fair to middling.
Mm, all right. What the fuck is middling?
It's in Texas, maybe. It's maybe Australian chick. But I love it when people decide to try music, you know, when everything else goes wrong. It's such a train wreck. It's always just great.
And, well, and so he was in the Back to the Future movies, and then now he's trying comedy. And not just comedy with a guitar.
Oh, excellent.
He's moving in on your turf,
nigga!
Oh,
my gosh. Biff.
Right, and not just comedy with a guitar, but there are some specific comedy songs about Back to the Future with a guitar, right, Lazlow?
In case people forgot about him.
Yes.
I thought you'd be really mean. Doesn't matter if I tell them that movies are pretend. They still want me to say it. What are you looking at,
What are you looking at,
Do you all hang out together. No, we don't. House crisping lover. Never talk to him. Back to the Future 4. Never happening. Stop asking me the question. Who did you like on the set? The lunch guy who was the biggest jerk. He got fired. Back to the Future 4. Just let it go.
Now, who would go to an evening of hearing this guy, like, sing about being on Back to the Future? What do you got, pictures of him, E-Rock?
Yeah.
Look, it says
right.
Tom Wilson, musician.
Yeah.
Actually had sort of a groovy island kind of vibe, you know. I could see some Buffett fans, maybe.
Yeah, but if...
crossing over.
I mean, dude, so if you're famous for one thing, let it go.
But it's the same people, you know, the people who like him are the same people who stand in line for 9 hours at a sci-fi convention to get an autograph from Jawa number 4.
Well, Jawa number 4 is a hard one to get.
Yo,
3 and 5 are always at those things, but number 4...
You know, everyone has fans, man, you know, it's just, it's weird.
Dude... Talking to Will Wheaton, every now and then he'll go to one of the Star Trek things. He says he has to go to like a decontamination chamber afterwards just to get himself straight.
I knew those people hated their fans, dude.
It ain't that, dude. It's not like that. But did you ever see that movie Trekkies?
Yeah.
Oh, it's
probably the best documentary about like the weird Star Trek fans.
Yeah.
The best part of that movie is the dentist. This dentist is such a Star Trek fan that he has all of his employees in the dentist office dress up in Star Trek uniforms. They have to, like, speak to each other, and yes, Captain, and warp factor 10, and, you know, whatever, give him a root canal, and the whole place is decked out like the Starship Enterprise.
That guy should not have nitrous.
No.
Correct. It's a bad scene.
That was weird. Have you heard of this stuff called slash fiction? Have you guys ever heard of this?
No, but I've heard of fan fiction, and you're in some of it, fool, because I did a Google search the other day.
I'm in fan fiction?
You're in some fan fiction.
What am I doing?
I don't know.
Fan fiction.
Well, you were in one of the... Dude, you're going to be like this Tom Wilson guy. You're going to be singing songs about Grand Theft Auto 3 in like 5 years. Right, you'll be up on stage singing Chatterbox. Singing
Cap the Whore. And
right, correct.
No, there's this slash fiction. It's this whole genre of fan fiction that's written by these people. It's written by mostly straight women, but it takes...
I thought you were going to say Slash.
From Guns N' Roses. Yeah.
It's written by Slash.
It's all about top hats. No, it's they take these the male characters from sci-fi movies like Star Trek or Star Wars, and they make up these really like hardcore explicit gay stories. So like Spock is banging Kirk, and the hobbits are all like in a damn orgy,
right.
And Anakin is like...
Right.
In Qui-Gon Jinn or whatever.
There's a crossover between Sling Blade and Star Wars.
Where's this going?
I don't know. I just think it'd be cool. I reckon I'm your daddy.
Okay,
you know,
it'd
be good.
Yeah.
It'd be good. You ought not to kiss your sister in that second movie.
You know, that kind of thing. Is that your one imitation of the guy from Sling Blade?
That's it, dude.
Okay.
That,
mm-hmm.
I tried to do Arnold, but...
No.
And
right.
I did an Italian one time on ONA, and about 80 people called in and fucking douched me about it.
You can do an Indian, though. I heard that.
Yeah, I'm good Indian. All Muslims sound the same.
Mm-hmm.
That's what Hollywood has taught me. You were supposed to talk to your lame sister, Reed, but...
She's dissing us.
She's dissing us.
I think she's afraid. She's afraid that last time she was on the show, even though she's my sister and she's off limits, 2 of the 4 people on the show asked for her phone number.
Right. And also the fact that right after we had your sister on our show, she, like, OD'd or something, and you had to rush her...
She didn't OD.
Dude, you had to rush her to the hospital and have her stomach pumped.
No.
You stupid...
But she didn't know D.
Okay, dude.
She just got.
I know,
flu.
And I'm on the phone. I'm on the phone with him, and I'm like, dude, she's got dreadlocks. She's got her nose pierced, and I thought she was gonna like molest Wayne because of his dreadlocked beard and the fact that he has THC covering every orifice in his body.
She just wanted to buy from Wayne,
and
she didn't have to buy.
Yeah, I don't want to know what the price was for whatever you gave her, but she did not OD. She just had the flu, and I had to take her to the hospital because she was visiting, and there's no doctor for it.
You know what a river in Egypt is, my friend? Denial.
It was exhaustion, I swear.
Yeah, exactly.
She was dehydrated.
Lindsay Lohan.
She must have had a cold, because she was sniffing a lot.
But we tried to get her to call in, and she was...
Do you remember when we had a gentleman on, his name was Brandon, who...
I've seen him.
No, we had the gentleman on, Brandon, who, I believe went... Went like when he was married, drove like 60 to
100
miles or something to go bang a stripper and then married her.
Yeah.
He is calling into the show again.
What's up, Brandon?
How is life with a stripper treating you?
Hey, you gotta be careful. I'm on
the
line.
Oh, shit, the bed.
Hi, honey.
Hi.
Yeah, see, how's it going, Lazlow?
We're sneaky.
Now, okay, so we got his part of the story on one of our previous episodes.
Yeah.
He was married, but he was driving to see you.
Yeah, after a while.
And at the strip club?
Yeah.
Okay. At what point did he stop stuffing 20s in your panties?
Well, he was kind of a cheapie. He never really stopped shoving.
Wow. Did he do like Jim Florentine and rip the dollars in half and do two stuffs for a buck?
I knew this was a bad idea. Hey, honey, they want to talk to you.
Now, are you still stripping?
Me? Oh, God, no.
Okay.
No, we have kids now.
I'm so sorry. When I say stripping, I mean dancing. I love you.
What?
Did you consider yourself a
dancer? That's what we tell the kids, right?
Well, we don't tell them anything yet.
Did you tell them you were in Cats? What did you? So, what do you? You don't tell them anything yet, but the superhero thing's going to have to come out at some point, right?
Oh, eventually.
Now,
yeah.
What's that conversation? It's
first. It of course it'll have to be censored and age appropriate and.
Censored?
You know.
What are you going to do? Like, get a couple of, like, dolls out or something?
No. No, I said like... censored, not illustrated.
No. I was going to draw it as a children's
yeah,
book,
exactly.
Maybe.
Right.
Sometimes mommies forget
story.
Their clothes.
Right. And shove their hoochies in people's faces for money.
Beautiful. Yeah, yeah.
Well, you take this all very well, I have to say.
Oh, well, thank you.
And what about, now, Brandon, your ex-wife?
Yeah.
Now, how does she feel about getting left for a stripper?
You know what? I don't even think she knows.
Oh, she's got to know by now. See, I don't think, unless she was a fucking moron, I don't think that she even cared. Because, you know, he would come and, come into the club. He would be there for a couple of hours, and it would take him 2 hours to drive home. You know, and unless she was an idiot, I don't
now,
think she
So he was a regular?
That.
Yeah, he was a regular.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
What? Regular?
Yeah, you were.
I was only there like once a month, or is that being a regular?
That's a regular.
Yeah.
Is it? Regular
fee.
Damn. You had to save up your money.
You come into a club and you specifically get dances from just one person.
Yeah.
The only person you're there to see. That's a regular.
Now, challenge. How real quick, because we're running out of show.
Yeah.
What was the transition from thanks for the money, here's my hoochie, to thanks for the money, you ain't getting no hoochie? How did he approach that?
It's when she said, I'm pregnant.
Jesus.
Oh,
how romantic.
We're going to continue with no hoochie if you keep it up.
Wow. All
did
right.
Did you visit the club that month?
No, I said like, censored, not illustrated.
I was going to draw it as a children's
yeah,
book,
exactly.
Maybe.
Right.
Sometimes mommies forget
story.
Their clothes.
Right. And shove their hoochies in people's faces for money.
Beautiful. Yeah, yeah.
Well, you take this all very well, I have to say.
Oh, well, thank you.
And what about, now, Brandon, your ex-wife?
Yeah.
Now, how does she feel about getting left for a stripper?
You know what? I don't even think she knows.
Oh, she's got to know by now. See, I don't think, unless she was a fucking moron, I don't think that she even cared. Because, he would come and, come into the club. He would be there for a couple of hours, and it would take him 2 hours to drive home. Unless she was an idiot, I don't
now,
think
so he was a regular?
That.
Yeah, he was a regular.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
What? Regular?
Yeah, you were.
I was only there like once a month, or is that being a regular?
That's a regular.
Yeah.
Is it? Regular fee.
Damn.
You had to save up your money.
You come into a club and you specifically get dances from just one person.
Yeah.
And it's the only person you're there to see. That's a regular.
Now,
challenge.
How real quick, because we're running out of show.
Yeah.
What was the transition from thanks for the money, here's my hoochie, to thanks for the money, you ain't getting no hoochie? How did he approach that?
It's when she said, I'm pregnant.
Jesus.
Oh,
how romantic.
We're going to continue with no hoochie if you keep it up.
Wow. All right.
Did you visit the club that month?
Did what now?
Did he visit the club that month that you came up pregnant?
Oh, no. That was... It was after.
That was later.
Yeah. Oh,
okay. How did you pick her up?
We've been seeing each other like a year and a half.
I want to know the line, though. What is the line for guys to pick up strippers? What did you say to her?
Here's what I forgot to tell you last time.
You got 30 seconds.
second time I went in, I said, I want to draw you.
Yeah, that was it. That was the illustration.
Oh, wow.
So bring a sketchbook and say, can I use you as a model? Works every time.
Dude, yeah. You've been watching fucking Titanic too much.
Yeah, I may have gotten the idea from Leo or something.
All right, Brandon actually drew the picture of all of us on the Lazlow Show website.
Yeah.
Brandon, thanks for calling in.
You bet.
Good luck, buddy.
Talk to you more.
Later.
I had to ask that dude. He works on video games and draws comic books for a living, and he's banging a stripper.
Right. Where did
I have a new hero.
Yeah. Right, exactly. Maybe she doesn't know that. Maybe they're keeping that a secret, too.
That he drew comic books?
That he does draw comic books.
Well, dude, comic books tend to be a problem in a relationship. Did your girl like give you shit about them?
She didn't care.
Dude, I've got comic books all over the house. I got to do something with them. You sell all yours on eBay any damn way.
Yeah, right.
So this has been the Lazlow Show, episode 24, or the super bonus episode. Thanks to Opie and Anthony for letting us come pollute their airwaves.
Yep, thanks, guys.
Thanks to E-Rock and Danny and Nathaniel and who's the other guy?
Travis
for letting us come on and helping us out. And the website's lazlow.com if you want to hear some of our past episodes.
Fuck.
Stall, dude.
How do you spell
Stall.
That website?
Huh?
How do you spell it?
L. Dude, we didn't get to the fact that I didn't get to read the hate mail about from the angry fan. Whenever
countdown.
You appear on Opie and Anthony's show, you do a lot of Sony cocksucking. Well, sir, Sony doesn't have a cock, and if they did, it'd be really little bitty.
Yeah. Thank you for listening to the last.